Sent you actually.
We're live.
Yes, we should be live.
What?
Hello, ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gents. What it do?
According to YouTube statistics, it's mostly gentlemen.
and the one girl in the community. Well, she didn't show up. That's lame. All right, what's up, guys?
Yeah. So first of all, thanks for doing this, especially on short notice.
Dude, this is amazing. I've been asking around, like, somebody needs to do a podcast, an interview type situation, and I'm like, finally, someone's getting around to it. That's really cool, man.
Yeah, I figured at the very least, it's interesting to get a different cardist perspective on various things. One of the recurring themes is creative process, which is something that a lot of people ask for.
Yeah, man, that's my whole bread and butter.
Nice.
I see you talked to Kevin Ho for like 5 hours. Like,
yep. That was something.
He told me, he was like, your move, let's see. He's like, yeah, you might be the first, the only other person to break 5 hours. I was like, not even close, man. I don't think so.
The funny thing is that he did all the talking too, man. I contributed maybe like 5%.
Makes it. But yeah, dude, creative process, that's, I get this question a lot.
Yeah, I imagine.
I had a video about this a while ago where I wanted to create like a framework to get, you know, to create like a sort of foundational understanding for people, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think I kind of missed the ball on that one. I actually took that video down. Mm-hmm. It was called How to Create Card Flourishes in 4 Minutes. I tried to approach it like an artist as opposed to as a cardist, not to make a distinction there.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
From more of a more formally artistic standpoint, I wanted to say like, okay, artistically, like what is a card flourish? What does it mean? What is it objectively? What is it? And I think that the terminology that I used was a little too artsy. You know what I mean? It was a little too, for example, the word aesthetic, like that, the second you use the word 60% of your audience.
Yeah.
I mean, immediately that is only applicable to a certain amount of people. So I think I tried, what I said was rhythm, size, and motion. That's what
makes a lot of sense.
You were saying that was difficult to wrap the head around. And I'm like, I can understand that. What I think I've honed in on now is that creating anything more or less is answering 3 questions. And that was like a huge epiphany for me. It was just that everything that you create is an answer to a problem. You know, like every creative challenge is sort of a prompt. And then what you spit out is your answer based off of how you were brought up and the material that you were exposed to. So namely, the 3 questions that come to mind are what, how, and why. So the first thing that I typically think of when I come to create something is just like, well, why are you doing it?
Right.
And I don't mean why in like a let's get introspective way.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, like really think like, why am I a cardist?
Yeah. No, it's interesting.
Yeah.
Because like it's the way I like to frame it is, why am I making this flourish in particular? Why is this different than anything else? So I think that's kind of the same idea.
I think every flourish has an objective. And if it doesn't have an objective, that makes it sort of fundamentally bad. Mm-hmm. When you find a move and you can't really quite put your finger on why it isn't good or why it's bad for that matter.
Yeah.
Typically, it's because you can't see the point.
Right.
Because you're like, okay, what exactly are they trying to communicate to me? I didn't get a chance to make it to Berlin this year. I was really upset. I wanted to meet you actually. I read your you remind me so much of Billy Markovsky. Not Markovsky. That's his Instagram name. Billy Markowitz. Billy Markowitz. In the sense that you guys are very niched in your approach, and you're also very clear in that you aim for like foundational comprehension. And that's like so cool to see. So I was like, all right, word, like there's another one of me like overseas. It's great. But one of the things I want to talk about at the con were those three questions: was how, why, and what. You know. So the example I was going to use was windshield, because windshield, I think, is probably one of the easiest to understand in terms of like what I'm trying to communicate. If you look at windshield, you know, and you ask yourself, what's the point? The point is this thing is you're blowing on the faggot. Right. Like, the point, it doesn't become a card flourish until they see that moment. Once they see that, it's like, oh, that's what you're trying to say.
Yeah, and the rest is kind of a wrapper for that enhances.
Exactly.
Exactly.
So you look at that, you say, this is the point, right? And then you look at the actual structure of the move itself, right? Which is this.
Yeah.
Right? This is the what. Yeah, so the Charlier over here,
okay. Yeah.
This card in the middle, that's the what. This over here is the why.
Right. You know what I mean? It's
this is the point, and now this is the structure that houses the why.
Right.
Now, the way that he gets there goes here. That was a creative decision.
Yeah.
That's the how. You know. So typically, as a creator, what you do is you usually figure out the why, or you might find a what. You might find a like a structure that makes you think like, oh, that looks kind of cool. You know what I mean? Like you might. Yeah. It might not be as structured as say, I want a flourish that you blow on. You know, like. Frankie found that mechanic, and that was the reason he made windshield.
Right.
Because he found that, and he was like, all right, I just need to create the most, you know, bare bones, skeleton, easiest structure that I can to show off this, and that's it. And then once this is done, I just have to finish. I just got to finish it up. I always tell people that the easiest way to figure out what the purpose of a move is the moment when a move can be identified by its silhouette.
Yep. Yeah.
The moment that you can see what a move is just by its silhouette, you don't need to see any of it except its general shape.
Yeah.
That's the moment that makes it a card flourish, a real move, you know?
Yeah, that idea of silhouette is really interesting. Were you on the live stream for the CardistsCon? Did you see some of the talks?
Oh, no. Sure. I was actually in Chicago. Not for that weekend. I didn't get a chance to jump into it, which sucks because it's like I hear it was amazing. I'm so bummed out about that.
It's too bad. There's always next year.
How did you like it? Was it good?
Oh, yeah, it was great. It was fantastic. One of the interesting talks was given by Antoine Rioma. And he was talking about looking at flourishes from a computer science point of view. And the general gist of his talk was that there are certain cuts that you can describe in a short sentence. Those cuts are not necessarily simple technically or anything, but they can be described really simply. So for example, bloom, it's like the packet fans out, right?
Yeah, that's one moment. And it's not really a buildup or a decline. It's more just, it happened.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, even the squeeze, which is a bit more of a cut, just saying squeeze, you get the idea that you've got this squeezing action that goes on and whatnot.
Yeah, there's definitely a moment when it becomes like, oh, that's the Darignal shape.
The silhouette. Yeah. And so I think that's the same thing, is that there those cuts that are distinguishable enough that you can describe them really shortly are the ones that really stick and that are good in a way.
Yeah. I talked to Chase about this a lot, actually, you know, and how it's kind of funny that dealer's grip cuts tend to be what we call all closer in that, like, you kind of like start, like the moment is like immediate, the moment just happens, and then the entirety of the cut is resolution,
right?
And resolution is like, you like cardists just eat that up because it's logic that's very consumable. It's very consumable logic. You can like respect that. They, you know, a good example of it is you know, accurate is like,
yeah, that's what here. I was thinking about.
You're here, and it's like, okay, that literally you're in your, that's the point.
Yep.
You're at the peak of the move in half a second, and then the rest of the move, which actually occupies most of the time that you spend watching the card flourish, has nothing to do really with the point of the move. It's just the resolution. but that resolution speaks to us as cardists so much, you know. I always thought it was funny that that the verts were called the verts, because they are kind of the equivalent of vert skateboarding, in that it's very like very, very globally appealing. Just the, there is like, you know, they do the anaconda and stuff like that. And the moves that they choose to show are very straight to the point.
Yeah. And they're very effective.
Yeah, exactly. And that's, you know, it's just funny that their name literally is that we are verts. We are vert skaters, vert cardists. You can see that's their approach. I've been so happy to see, you know, Squids, just because,
yes,
you know, it created sort of a justification, at least in the real world, to be a packet cutter, and like just a packet cutter, you know, because it's like you can show. I find that I show them when I have cards, I'll show them a packet cut, and then I'll immediately jump to like a spring, because I know that that's what's gonna like get an emotional reaction out of them.
Yeah,
you know, and that's frustrating. It's frustrating because when they see a packet cut, they go, "Oh, you can do that. You can do that. All right." Cool. But like they want to see the, you know what I mean? They want
the
to see
the and the yeah
and the you know and the yeah. And but with this, the only logical thing that you can do with this is a packet cut. You know, and it's just like and I think that I don't think it'll replace cards.
I think at the very least they're complementary. At least the way
we were never preaching it as a replacement. We were always saying that what we wanted out of this was to, number one, distinguish the cardist from the packet cutter. Mm-hmm. I think if you make that distinction, that the packet cutter has a separate brain, and that like the system of thinking is actually very distinctly separate, I feel, from how you create a card flourish. Mm-hmm. At least in the sense that structure plays more of a component, whereas with cardistry, or more traditional cardistry, it's more about the discovery of a moment. You know what I mean? Like if you find a compelling enough purpose, like water wheel,
for example.
Water wheel is just a moment. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's just, the moment itself is resolving itself.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's the same thing for the anaconda and the spring. Both of those moments have built in resolution. There's no need to resolve them.
Pan it out. Know? Yeah,
exactly. You know, with packet cuts, you have to actually create the stage for an event, and then you have to deconstruct that stage. And that's a different way of thinking. You know what I mean? You're a packet cutter for sure. I mean, like, I actually, like, really distinctly, I mean, you've stood out. You put up this cut maybe, I don't know. It was before the con, but it's like this thing that flips back like this and then goes forward again. And then you close it like that.
I actually found a new closer on this. Should I put it out? I don't know.
You got it.
We'll go,
you got it,
go nuts.
That's so good.
And then the new closer ends like this.
That's wild, bro. That's crazy. Because, I mean, the whole thing is like you got this motion of like the double kind of Alejandro action there. Yeah. and you throw in like a kind of clip as well with the index in the middle.
It's so, kind of a bullshitty move. It's actually really...
It's so wonky, bro. Like, that's the exact thing that I would have been trying to make like a year ago, and I wouldn't have been able to make it.
This has been a year in the making. Like, I've just at CardistryCon, I found the new closer. But yeah, I've had this thing where I had this open like this. I had this for months without getting anywhere, and it took me forever to do the flip down and then move on.
It's always right there. You know what I mean? It's always right in front of you. It's the funniest thing. It's just like the next step you needed to make. I mean, Chase was telling me about how he made SpongeBob, and the connection was identical to what you just did. It's just like he just realized he could pop it out the side and pull it through, and he's just like, that's the move. But definitely with cuts that are founded upon a structure. That's a funny idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cuts, I think, can be founded on structure.
Yeah.
It's harder for more traditional card flourishes to be founded on a context, on a structure.
Yeah. So I think one of the differences is that when you're doing a packet cut, you can kind of tell, and I'm not sure if this is the right word, but like a story. Story, not in the sense, you know, a thing with characters and stuff.
But like a progression.
And there's, I don't know, there's something there. It's kind of like a song in a way.
Yeah. For sure. It's a flow of energy.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. And so as I think that's a good way to think about packet cuts, because it allows you to think about, okay, so you need to have, you know, beginning, middle, and end. But also the end has to make sense with the beginning. You can have something that echoes what happens before, and you can have theme that happens throughout. And all of my cuts that happen to be popular are ones that have like a really strong theme. So something, something Sisyphus, which is this cut, is just very simply, there's a thing rolling down.
When I saw that, I was like, that is evident purpose. That's what happens. You can see the point. Why are you showing me that? You're showing me that move because it's doing what it's doing.
Exactly.
And that's what you're trying to say.
I had the motion, one of the motions, I forget where I started. I think I was like here, and I was like, oh, okay, I can drop this here. And I had, turns. Yeah, all right, let's do more of it and see where it goes. And I just had this idea. Yeah.
That is a great way to create mechanics, is to just say, like, let's just go further. Let's just push that exact mechanic and just do it again and again and again and see if you can literally just push through, you know, and come out with a revolution, you know. I mean, Chase's download, MB3, I feel really changed people's understanding of how to make a cut. Mm-hmm. I think that Bowtie and Nimbus have a few understandings that are like so prominent now in the current bad cutting community. Like Bowtie, the idea of just finding a relationship and then just repeating it.
Yeah.
Like that I see everywhere now. It's like everyone's looking for that new Bowtie, you know, relationship. But what makes Bowtie so great is that it's inside this shape.
Yeah. You know what I
mean? Which is, that's like as packet cutter as you can get is like here, you know? And, and then Nimbus, it takes logic from Dominique's Prime Meridian. And the idea is to have a very interesting one-handed thing that is substantiated by a top hand, you know, or an outside hand that just kind of is around it. You know, Prime Meridian is just this packet just moving with the one-handed cut.
Yeah.
You know, and it has a real functional purpose, but the one-handed cut can exist without this.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And the
main role of this is to substantiate, you know, is purely to substantiate just that one-handed cut. And I love that idea. Substantiate. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting because then you have Zui who comes along and does his insane top hand thing with the bottom thing. And the funny thing is that they're very different cuts, and they have like they give a different feeling as a result, because the Nimbus, you know, you have all the focus is on one thing, whereas what is Mocking God? Mocking God just has an overall feel of spinniness.
Yeah, to a spectator seeing that, it's just like it's very easy to describe that one. But at the same time, if their description of Mocking God may more or less be the same description as
Squall,
or my double Nimbus. I mean, like just the idea of do the spinny one.
Yeah,
do the one that spins. And, but that's the point of that move, is that he wanted his own spinny thing.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
He's known for having some of the most distinctive spinny cuts. And I was joking around with Kevin a while ago. I'm like, Zui's critique of every cut is, needs more spin.
Yeah.
It needs more spin. I'm like, that is actually it, though. But, I find that a lot of moves that I ran into came about due to a a precedent that I was trying to meet. The first move I ever made that I consider to be like I put one on the board. Like I actually like chucked a dart and it landed somewhere in the proximity of the bullseye.
Right.
You're never really quite there.
Yeah.
Dropbox is probably like the closest thing I made to like, that's it. That's all you need to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can't really improve.
Yeah. It's just, there's more you can do with it, but the idea is just done. Mm-hmm. You don't actually need to, Lacoste was the first thing that ever felt like a move. I probably can't even do this move anymore. It's like this thing or whatever. That I funny enough, the way that happened, if you've ever seen D4i's movie, you ever seen D4i's video Drift?
Yes.
Drift was a huge deal for me. This was the first time that somebody proved to me that you could take a packet cut and make people feel like they were watching Aviv. I had never seen somebody get both ends of the spectrum and
put it together and
create something that everybody liked. You know, everybody in the community liked it for the same reasons they like an Aviv video, for the same reasons they like a Tobias video. It's just like, that is everything. And my whole gimmick was like, I'm just going to do that. I just want all of my material to be that. And that, okay, done. I got like done. I'm I got that question sorted out real early. I didn't really understand what he was doing. I just understood that it was five packets. The middle one was spinning. And it involved this parallel corner rotation.
Yep,
you know what I mean? I was like, okay. All right, there. So what do? You just, it's funny because to this day, this cut still doesn't have like a real opener. Like the opener is like literally just, you're here and then you put it in the place where it needs to be. And there's no pretty way to get into it. You're just there.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
I mean, Squall is the same way. Squall doesn't really have an opener. No one cares.
No one cares because the moment is so beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, but truthfully, what happened with this cut was I was filming the video terminal. I did not have this move going into the video. I hadn't even started it. What I did was it started out as this. It started out as just one of these things.
Right.
It was like just generic spinny clip things that you just do when you're bad. and I wanted to just start the video off with something spinny,
right?
So
I
went like it wasn't enough, but I knew that was somewhere in the vicinity of what I was going for.
Yeah.
So what do when it's not enough? You add a packet. You add a packet, and that substantiates your lame idea. So you're here, and I just went, all right, I'm just gonna get a packet. I didn't have a way to do it. I wasn't thinking of how to get into this grip.
Right. Yeah.
I knew no one was ever gonna see the opener. It was for a video.
Yeah.
I had to create the moment. You know, that was it. So, I'm here, and I start doing that thing, and I accidentally kicked the packet, and I was just like, what? You know what I mean? And it just became like 20 minutes of me just like moving it around and stuff. and it's funny because the Lacoste that I ended up with in that video, no idea how I did it. No idea what I was doing. I had to end up reverse engineering my own move video later. Cause I was like, how did you create that moment? I remember that it was such a big deal. Cause like, Frankie commented and Ambrose commented and like Dimitri commented and Nikolai commented, and I was just like, woo! I did it, I got one. I put one on the board, finally. You know, it never did I have had I gotten a just unanimous, and always the feedback that I had gotten from people had consisted of something along the lines of, oh yeah, you're getting there. Yeah. I could see you could totally be somebody if you spent like 3 years. You could totally, I can picture this.
Yeah. And I can see that in a bunch of people on Instagram, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, I can see your brain is doing something great. You just need more experience.
Exactly. It's just like literally all you have to do is just create more. And you'll be insanely good in like 3 months. Three months even. And this was the first video, the first move even, where I the feedback that I got was like, damn. What? You know what I mean? Like, I'd be like, Frankie messaged me on Facebook about that. Like, yo, that first move, though, was that good shit. And I was just like, all right, okay, I'm God. I mean, like, that that was the first time that I ever felt like, okay, all right, I'm just good. I can totally do this.
Just the best.
Yeah. I'm just, that's a funny story, too, how that happened. It's just so funny that, you know, in the beginning, I encourage people to make garbage. Just don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Just all you have to do is you just have to know the point of your move. You know, I understood the point. The point of my move was I wanted one of D4. I wanted that cut that he had. I just wanted that. And once I can create something that's, you know, an emotional response.
Right.
That's comparable to that, I'm like, all right, that's a success. That constitutes a success. And like, if you know, if you're just kind of chucking darts, you know, there's a difference between a guess and an educated guess. Huge difference. You know, I'm like, if you're just saying like, all right, well then why not over here, why not do that, it's just like, but if you're working towards an emotional response, mm-hmm. and you know when the move that you've created actually creates that moment and that feeling for you, then you know that you've succeeded. You know, it has nothing, I never know what my move is going to look like going into it while I'm doing it. It's nothing that I honestly don't care how it looks. I don't, because how it looks, I find out how it looks during the creative process. You just go in knowing what it's supposed to do.
Yeah. And I mean, I think there's also a couple of different ways of creating. There's, you know, some of what I do is just doing random things and sitting on my bed for like 2 hours and just doing a whole bunch of useless stuff. And then one thing kind of comes out at some point and then just build off of that. Or maybe like something Sisyphus was, okay, I had this idea of something rolling. I want to do more of that. And it was almost straightforward, really, just because I had the idea and I was just in the right place to do that. So there's a bit of that. Have you gotten your hands on Dimitri's book?
I haven't. I saw it briefly when I was in the East Coast Jam the other day, and somebody had it there, and I was just like, "Oh, what? This is the book." I heard about this book years ago, and it was just like, "Did you know Dimitri has a book, dog?" Yeah. I was just like, "What? What?" And this was before the Danes put out their books. This is before like I had were like the only books that I knew about were like Jerry's books, and like DeVoe's notes.
Notes?
That's it. Yeah. I didn't know anything about. Yeah. He does have some notes. Yeah.
Interesting.
Some of them, you know, some of them are good. He's got some funny ideas in there, but there was this idea that Dimitri wrote a book about how to make a card flourish, and it was like.
Yeah,
you're telling me. I got into cards because of Dimitri. He was the first guy. Well, I had seen cardistry prior to that, but I didn't feel compelled to be a cardist until I saw Dimitri. I was like, oh shit, like that's what it means to be like a card artist.
Yeah.
I was like, that's the first time I, like with opera, it was the first time that I saw somebody like just art the shit out of it. You know? wow. And it's such a, the video takes itself so seriously, but that was cool. That was as cool as you could be for me at least.
Yeah.
And what's funny is that my style is like, I really don't take like any inspiration from him, like from a mechanical standpoint.
Yeah.
But it was just the precedent. It was just the idea that you could be that good in everybody's eyes. It was just like, that I had never, you know. And then the second time that happened was Aviv.
Oh, fucking yes.
Aviv. I know you think he's the best. I know. I've seen you. Aviv, dude, Aviv's like.
He's just on a different plane is the thing.
It's just because he speaks a different language. That's my whole, is that his style is that of pure raw experimentation. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah,
it's just experimentation, and that's all. That's it. Is all he does. He sits and he thinks. All right, let's try to find a new mechanic, and then he uses his general intelligence and his intuition to just build off of a general mechanic. You know what I mean? It doesn't seem to me that he sits and thinks with a purpose in mind, or that he tries to control it or be deliberate about it. It's more so just like, I'm just gonna look around. Yeah, yeah. I'm just gonna look around, and I know that I'm smart enough so that when I run into something, I'll be able to handle it and turn it into something that's greater than me. And he's incredible, incredible. Wow, man! When I first saw him, it's actually funny. I commented on I think the first time I saw him was Sequence. Actually, it was the first time I saw him was on and it was. It was because it was on cardistry.com. The video came out and it was like from Dan and Dave. So like,
oh okay. Yeah. Yeah.
It was like from Dan and Dave. And I was just like, what the fuck is this? Who is this man? Cause I had never heard of him. I thought he was like the Chase Duncan of that time. I thought he was just this guy that like they found and they're like, let's show the world Aviv, but no, I was just totally wrong. Like he's been around for years, and I'm.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I actually commented on that video. I was like, "Who is this guy, man?" I'm like, "I've never seen." I think Frankie actually replied to that. He was just like, "He's not new." I'm like, I'm dumb.
"Well, whoops."
Frankie thinks I'm dumb. Oh my god, it's over. It's over for me. I'll never have a following. yeah, and then his project came out, and I was just like, "You can buy this stuff."
Yeah,
I was so stoked about that. But like, it was the only cardistry project outside of Monument that I was compelled to. Well, actually, no, I didn't buy Monument for this reason. I bought Monument because it's Dimitri's project.
Yeah,
I was not gonna get Dimitri's DVD. I got Aviv's DVD. Because I couldn't figure out any of it by watching it. And that made me so mad. That made me so mad, dude. Because, like, as a shitty amateur cardist, like, all you do is just, like, you just, you know, you sit and, like, hit pause with your nose. try to read up, figure it out. Couldn't do it. Nothing that he did was based off traditional mechanics, that at least that I could understand.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't wrap my head around it. So I had to get that project. I recommended that project to everyone and their mom. I was like, you get this project, it'll change your life. And then I think 5 months after that, I remember I was in a group chat with these kids. I was like, you get added to group chats a lot. It's whatever. But like these kids were saying like, I don't know, man. I don't know how I feel about that. I don't know how I feel about that project. Yo, it's like, man, whatever, man. I'm just like, oh, have you seen the project? Have you bought the project? Because everything on there has got something incredible to take away from it. You know, I'm like, just even the small, like, the just little things. I mean, like Matrix.
Yeah.
Like Matrix is just amazing. I had no idea what was happening. I thought Matrix was incredible I thought Matrix was amazing because you got to this moment and then this card and this card happened at the same time. And I was just like,
how
are you? Cause I couldn't break down where he was getting what card from where.
Yeah.
No. I'm like, oh dude, Aviv, you're so good. You're so good, Aviv. But that was a big deal, though. That feedback of Aviv, that means something. You know, that told me something that, like, I know for a fact that this man is smart, is a genius. Like, of course.
Yeah.
So why aren't they getting, like, why aren't they getting it? What's wrong? And I realized it's just like, you know what? They might appreciate and respect his material, but it's because they cannot understand an application for it, or they can't see a place that something that they can steal, right? That I think really gets in the way, and I think that comes back to this idea of understanding the point, you know?
Yeah,
it's just like it's a lot of it's just like general Aviv awesomeness. But that's it. It's like, oh, that's an Aviv move.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. When you see an Aviv move, it's an Aviv move.
The purpose of the move is it's an Aviv move. Like, that's right. The point. And they see that, and they don't process it as, like, being distinctly separate. I think Matrix and Tetris on the Aviv Tetris, not Regis Tetris, probably have the clearest moments in that. And Broken Triangle having probably the most obvious, you know, purpose in that it's just a triangle that you break. Yeah, I mean, so it's like, yeah, okay.
Yep.
Broken Triangle. Pretty straightforward. Now, dude, that just got me thinking about, you know, card flourishes that have names that, like, tell you what the point is.
Yeah, that's something.
Do you have any of those?
I mean, there's something Sisyphus, which is kind of a meta joke because, so I don't know if you're familiar with the Greek mythology, but Sisyphus is a dude who is...
I should be, I'm Greek. I don't know any of that stuff.
Sisyphus is a dude who was banned to roll a big rock up a mountain for eternity. And when it gets up to the top of the mountain, rolls back down. He's like, oh shit.
It's like that rolling thing that you do.
Yeah, so that's the idea is that the this is like the rock that's flowing down and hitting the bottom of the thing.
That's crazy, bro.
So the idea is that at first I'd call it Sisyphus, but I thought, well, there's something funny about having like a sentence for your cut. So I wanted to have something like
the name of a Panic at the Disco song.
And so I was thinking like integrating Sisyphus into like, oh, Sisyphus is despair or some bullshit like that.
Yeah.
You know what? No, just something Sisyphus. Like, just something about Sisyphus. People get the idea. It's fine.
Yeah. You know, my first thought was that was like, oh, the name Rolling Stones was taken. Oh, so I was like, oh, all right, that's fine, whatever.
Yeah. Actually, I had a few other names. I also had one of them was Catch Me If You Can, which is a bit more generic. I like that, yo.
That's cool. Because like Above the Horizon's another one, really famous. Mm-hmm. Like, it was just like a bunch. I mean, when I heard that, I was like, you can do that? I was like, wait, yeah, you can do that.
Yeah.
Call it whatever you want, and no one can say anything about it.
But, and the other one I had was, I catch me if you can, is, oh, also, Why Won't You Love Me? Because it's running away.
I probably would have steered away from that one first. I can appreciate it. I can dig it. My favorite name of a card flourish ever is Prince Charming. There's no contest because, like, I swear he picked that name just so that he could have the moment where people go, why? And he goes, because. just because he wants to be able to say it. But he's like, oh, because of the Prince Charming is the only man that can flirt with one hand. And I was just like, oh, that you, dude, the name is a card flourish. I'm like, the name in and of itself is impressive to me. Oh god, it's like a 1-2 punch. I'm like, that's Oliver with Prince Charming and Travolta. Those are like the two names that made me think, like, you gotta get your shit together, dude. You can't keep up with these guys if you don't like step it up with these names, man. You know, my general strat in the beginning was to steal what they were doing. Henrik has a move called Nintendo, amazing cut. So I'm like, all right, brand names, that's okay apparently. brand names are okay, apparently. Brand names, celebrities, and if you can, and if you can make a pun, you know what I mean. If you can say, if the name has an explanation, then those are the three options for me, at least. Well, they were. Now it's like try to come up with like now the best thing you can do is try to come up with the name that actually describes the move.
Yeah. That's usually what I try to do with my names.
Yeah. I mean, I have my fair share of names that just have nothing to do with the cut. Like, I mean, Penny Arroyo. I mean, Dropbox does have a lot to do with
the cut. Oh, yeah. Yeah. That just makes sense.
I mean, it was funny because Dropbox initially, the reason why Dropbox was called Dropbox for a couple of reasons is because it was the website Dropbox. It's like there's the upload and then there's the download. And the image processes.
Oh, wow. All right. Too deep.
So you could store it away for later. That was the
whole thing. Wow.
Yeah, it was this whole. All right. I was ready. I was ready to come on and just be like, yeah, it's called Dropbox because, you know, upload and download. And have everybody in the room just be like, oh, he's so much smarter than we thought. Blah. But, like, but then it just never happened. But Dropbox is a really interesting idea, man. Only because it's a bit of a from a creative standpoint, it's a bit of a lucid dream in that it's the first and only time I can say that I know what I was thinking prior to making it, while I was making it, and after I was done. Like, there was a moment where I was just like, I want this, it has to be this, and then I, you know, it was the only time that I just, oh, I made the shit out of that move, dude. Like, I could say, like, every single, that was going to be what my lecture was I was going to sit and I was going to say, this is everything I did because it happened in 30 minutes and it was done. That was it. Is that there's this idea that you have to work on your move for months, years. You cannot have a water wheel. You cannot have a bloom or a satellite or an incredible classic move without it being this grueling uphill, horribly painful process I've got like a whole bulletin board over here with like possible variations that I'm like, oh no, that won't work. Crumples it up, throws it away. No, that's not at all. No, that is not at all how Dropbox happens. I think at the root of everything great I've ever created was a very, very shallow motivation. I think that at the root of it, it's I want to impress that guy. I just want that guy to like me. and at the time, and this ties back into what I was saying about everything that you create is an answer to a question. You know what I mean? And you pose that question, that prompt. You create that prompt, and then this is the solution. So what exactly was I solving at the time? This was around the time when the Fontaine Femme came out. Mm. My favorite video. Fontaine Femme is my favorite video. I think all that, all time, actually. Right. Yeah. I think that I've never had more fun watching a video.
Yep.
I think that I've never been more surprised watching a video. There's genuine surprise throughout this video.
Yeah,
real surprises. Yeah. And that's something that you just, I love liquid paper, but the thing about liquid paper is that I knew it was coming.
Oh yeah.
You know that the verts are gonna come out. Darren's going to do water wheel. You know what I mean? Like, you might see a few new things here and there, but you know that the filming is gonna be like some Discovery Channel level, you know, filming, like, and they're gonna be impeccable. They're gonna be just flawless in how they do it.
Yeah,
and they do that, but you know it's coming. You know it's coming, and it wasn't particularly fun for me. That's my big problem. Is that it's just like, this is card flourishing. It's an excellent card flourishing video. Mm-hmm. You know, I just think that Fontaine Femme as a cardistry video, which is just spoke volumes to me. It was just like, I was like, this is what it means to be a cardist. It's to meet these people that have nothing to do with each other, that were brought together deliberately Yeah, we brought together to some random place, you know, and they were just like, let's just make something awesome. Let's just make something cool.
Yeah.
And there was a jam in the video.
Yeah.
You know, one thing that baffles me about the Verts videos is that they live near one of the biggest infrastructures for cardistry, and they haven't shown a jam in their videos, but it doesn't fit in with the look.
Yeah, it's not their
thing. It's not their shtick. Yeah. And if we're talking about cardistry, trying to find a video that represents cardistry, mm-hmm. you know, like you've got Chase, and you know what I mean, a raw packet cutting. You got you got Frankie with like his classics, Above the Wind Chill. You know, you got all that. You've got this thing that debuted in Fontaine Family.
Basically, yeah.
That was the first time you saw Floating Cards, and then you have no one had ever seen Noel just fucking go off. Like, Noel, yeah. That was like, what? Like, going into it, I had no expectation. It was like, I just didn't have an opinion. I had no opinion. And then it was just like, who is this person? You know, I haven't had that emotion in so long. So, again, so many emotional moments throughout it. Like, oh, look, they thought of that. And they had the group cardistry. You know what I mean? You know, Liquid Paper had group cardistry, but Fontaine Fam, like, come on, they had the thumbnail. was you know, like that moment of flipping it, and then they had the, you know, the strings of Isolations where they like sitting in front of each other. I thought it was amazing. So I saw that video and I'm like, this is the future. Guys, this is it. I gotta like I at that moment I was fully prepared, drop everything I was doing. I was like, I'm gonna be the fifth guy on this squad. That was gonna be my goal. Is like, what can I do that'll make them not want to sponsor me? That'll make them want me to like be there. You know what I mean? Like, forget sponsorship. I'm gonna be that. You know what I mean? I wanna be that, bro. Like, yes. And so you think to yourself, like, all right, what am I gonna do? And what am I gonna do? Yeah, I'm like, this is a hell of a Saturday night contest. I'm like, this is like dang, bro, like, that's a prompt. Is how do you, you know, be a part of the coolest squad in the world at the time? Like, to me, that was the coolest group of card guys. Like, the first, like, boy band since the Verts. It was the first boy band since the Verts, man. Like, that was such a
hardest boy band.
Like, I was like, okay, all right. I can't make a packet cut because I know that Chase will be able to appreciate that for what it is, but the other three will be able to appreciate it as like general cardistry that is very well done, mm-hmm. but it won't speak to them in like a, oh, we can use this, like I would need that guy, you know, to contribute to our whole shtick. So I was like, all right, packet cut, that's out. I know that my answer to this problem will probably appeal to Chase because Chase is a really cool guy.
Yeah.
Chase is a really cool guy, and he'll see what you're doing. He'll just be, oh, yeah, look at you. Look at you kill it. Look. Yeah, I'm like, all right. Chase will probably get it no matter what I do. I didn't know what Zach's style was yet at the time. I had seen Black Belt. I think Black Belt was before that. I saw Black Belt, okay, Isolations.
I was really impressed with Black Belt, actually.
Black Belt was the first time where I was like, shit, Zach.
Yeah.
Zach, bro, like, Bloom, as far as I'm concerned, like, after Bloom, Zach was done with Carter's. He's already done. Like, he has a water wheel, you're done. That could be a Darren move. And they put it in the Verts video. that's how you know. And, you know, so but I didn't have a good this thing where he got like the car here and he blows on it and it, like,
yeah,
I was woo.
Yeah.
There was that video and Hook, because it was like his first like cut. I was like, oh shit, he could do this. Like, Zach can do it, man. So I saw Isolations. I'm like, all right, Isolations. I know Frankie, also Isolations. No, Isolations. All right, three out of four. three out of four. I'm getting this vibe that isolations is something I might want to consider. Here's my problem with isolations. I suck at them.
Yeah, they're actually hard.
Dude, I'm so bad at it. Even though I totally understand what I'm supposed to do, like any of this, any stick, yeah. I suck at it. I'm so bad at it. Anything that requires my hands to be in a certain condition just makes me so mad. I guess because I'm just like, why is it that I can't do this on Wednesdays? Like, why is it do this all the time? And all right, an isolation. That's the answer. I need an isolation, and that's what's gonna get me onto the Fonte Fair, but I'm gonna be famous. Blah, blah, blah. But it can't be an isolation. So I have an interesting dilemma here where I need an isolation, but I don't want an isolation. So I tried to think of, like, all right, if I had to pick an isolation move to do, what would it be? And then I realized it's Tetris. Tetris is the closest thing to a cut that's also an isolation. You know what I mean? It's because the majority of it is me holding packets.
Right.
I just have to get the card here. That's it, you know? And then I realized, I'm like, yo, Tetris is out here, you know, and so is Alejandro's Mercedes. Mm-hmm. And I'm noticing this thing. I'm like, shit, yo, moves that are here have a tendency to do really well in the community. For some reason, moves that you hold out, you know, and now Kevin's Blockbuster.
Another
one. I'm like, you know what? I don't have a move like that. I had Bacardi, which doesn't really exist, but I had Bacardi, which is like this like spinning five packet display thing. I don't remember. I came with it while I was making Sucker Punch, and like everyone's like, please teach me that. I'm like, I don't know the move.
don't ask me.
I have no idea what I was doing. So, okay, again, we're painting a picture right now. I mean, because this is how a great move happens.
Yeah, really.
And what's funny is that all this happened, all of these things that I'm thinking about and explaining right now happened in half a second. You just know intuitively that you want things.
Yep.
You know what I mean? I know I just want one of these. Mm-hmm. You know what? Yeah. And I think that's going to get me onto the Fontaine fam. That's my goal. I just want them to love me, whatever. You know, whatever. Before my goals were like, yo, I want Dimitri to comment, or I want like 100 likes. Can we get 100 likes? We got triple digits. You're like, fucking triple digits. You know what I mean? Like, you're like, dang. I'm like, oh, I'm blowing up in the world. move that you hold out here. My theory is that now that you know that you need a move that's out here, it has to feel like an isolation. That just ruled out a bunch of shit.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like now your next creative decision is not going to be this.
Yep.
That's it. It's not so much trying to figure out what the next thing is. It's figuring out what the next thing isn't.
Yeah. You know, yeah. It's also important.
It's very important. Yeah. And that's why I'm saying, the first decision you make earnestly does not matter all that much. It just has to be within the parameters that you built for yourself coming into it. Mm-hmm. You know. So what did I do? What did I do? The first thing that I did when I made Dropbox is I went like this. And then I pulled two cards, one from the back and one from the front. The most flimsy, isolation-y thing I could think of was just, I have the deck. Nah. You know, now you're here. You just use basic logic. What can you do from here? Well, all I know is that I have fingers on this card, and I know that nothing about this grip is jumping out at me. Like, I can't go into anything especially easy. Yeah. All I'm thinking is like, okay, I can move this card. That's all I know. So what do? You move that card. You move this card, and I was like, okay. All right.
Okay, all right. I see exactly where this is going. Yeah.
All right. I went like there. I went, And I'm like, yeah, all right, that's cute.
Yeah, that's cute. That's cute. Cute is the word.
Cute. I actually cute. People, we use this word a lot now in the current community. I've been saying, here's something cute. Here's something, you know, this is a cute move. What does that mean? It means it is a cool part that is not substantiated by any structure of any kind.
Yeah.
That's cute. So just understand that. That's cute. that's what cute means when I'm trying, what I'm talking about when I say cute.
It's like just the why.
Exactly. It's just the why. There's no how or what. It's just, look at that. Yeah. But this is the part where it becomes a move. You know what I mean? You have to be able to tell yourself that's cute.
Yeah.
Now let's make it into a wow. Like a
being
bang.
Able to identify something that's cute. And when you're creating a whole bunch of stuff and messing around with stuff, that's I think one of the part where experience comes in.
Yeah. It's not easy.
Yeah.
It's not easy. That's where the seeing comes into it. You know what I mean? Like if the people that are able to see the relationships and they can see the moments, those are the people that make moves. You know what I mean? So just look for moments. That's all I tell people, is just look for things that jump out at you as being cool and then understand the structure that houses those cool things. Mm. You know what I'm here, and that's cute. That's cute, right?
Yep.
What do you do to substantiate something that's cute?
You add
a packet. You just add a packet. And what's the easiest way to add a packet? One-handed cuts. That's it. Because you have like 15 of them. You know what I mean? Like, there's so many one-handed cuts that you can use to substantiate your flimsy little cute thing. You know, so you're here. And now what did I think to do? The first thing I tried was I went like that. Because it made the most most sense.
Yep, yep.
Because I was like, all right, I'll push this one down. And now this is the it's symmetrical. So I was like, okay, all right, yeah. Mm-hmm. What do I know now from this moment? I know that I like that it's tall. You know, I like that it's this and not this.
Yes.
I'm like, okay. I got that. I know that my hand is up here for sure. Now, you know what I mean? We're building. We're getting these little bits of data that are like, oh, that's okay. Well, I'm putting that in there. I'll put that shit in there. So I keep doing this part. I knew from the beginning that this is bad, because the thing about Tetris is that it is beautifully consistent. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, you know that you can like this mechanic, you can always get to this position.
Right.
You know, but this, I was not confident in my ability to do that and have the cards be flush every single time. So I'm like, that's going to change. Doesn't matter. We just know that this is there. That's all we know. We just know that. So we're there. And we go up. I go, eh. And I'm like, okay, so tall is right. One-handed cut is right. I know that that's right. So what do? You just go into that thing you knew about already. And it didn't really work.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't really work, because you're here, this packet kind of gets in the way, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't line up nicely.
Get in there, but I know that the one-handed cut is a smart direction. It's just not that one-handed cut.
Right.
So I'm like, okay, back to here. Try a scissor cut. Whatever.
Sure.
Just run down the list. I know that a Charlier probably won't work, because a Charlier is very 3D. You know what I mean? I'm on the grid right now. I'm on the grid, the wall or whatever. So I tried a scissor cut, and I was like,
Ooh.
and then you just that's the move, man. Yeah. I like that, and for the first time you see your own cut. You see your own card
function,
and you realize that that is what it's supposed to be. And now everything is easy. Everything is fun now, because you know that you have it. And now all you have to do is the how. Mm-hmm. Is the how. How the fuck? How am I going to get here?
How
do I get here in a way that isn't dumb, right? So, you know, now you're just kind of poking around. I know that this is not working for me. You know, I know that moment of bringing these around wasn't working. I knew that from the beginning. So what did I do? I figured, oh, okay, I'll pull them both from this packet. I was like, all right. And then I went to that. And I almost uploaded that. I came really close. I came really close to going like this. Mm-hmm. And that is very close.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. Yeah.
And then I just realized that I was pushing my thumb through this gap when in reality, I just had to put it there. And then that just pops the card up. And I'm just like.
And yeah. It just works.
And then I put the deck down and I'm like, there you go. It's done. I'm done. I'm done with the move. It's over. I don't want to do anything else. I filmed it. I uploaded it. That whole process was 30 minutes. Mm. It's 30 minutes. It took me however long it just took me to explain it. And most of the talking was about everything that happened prior to the moment of creation.
Yeah.
You know, but like that moment is like such a split second thing. Oh, I want this for these reasons. Let me start and I'll try this out. I don't know how I feel about this. Oh, that's cute. Add a one-handed cut. That didn't really work. Add a different one-handed cut. Find a better opener. You're done.
Yeah.
That's it. And that's my best move. That's what I mean. It's the best thing I've ever made. And it's because I had the best reasons for making it. It was so much of a move before it was a move.
Right. I see. Okay. I see what you mean.
And that that's my only. I just want people to see that it is actually a very straightforward process, and that most importantly, it's not random. It's not random. There's an unpredictability.
Yeah.
But it's not random. You're not chucking darts blindfold.
No. Yeah.
You know, like you chuck a dart, you get feedback, and then that determines your next dart. Mm-hmm. You know, and then you gauge where the next one needs to go based off the feedback. And it's a guessing game. You know, it's I think anybody can do it. Mm-hmm. I think anybody can do it. And the people now are exceptionally good at doing it just because it seems like everybody is making these moves that have such purpose.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Oh, packet cutters especially. The East Coast packet cutters are like, what the fuck? I'm like, dude, you guys are all so good.
Yeah.
I'm like, all of you know what your styles are and what you're trying to be. And like, oh yeah, I'm based off this guy. I have these theories. And so I'm like, what the fuck? You are, you need to slow down. I'm like, you are starting to scare me. Oh my God, I don't think I can keep up with this.
Actually, there's a couple people in France who are really killing it.
Europeans, bro. The fucking Europeans, man.
Yeah. Have you seen the Cédric Pepi?
Yeah, I featured him.
Yeah.
Did I feature him? No, or did Frankie feature him?
He was on Best Cardist of Life, but...
Yeah, Frankie picked him. Yeah.
Yeah, he's going places.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, he's... Yeah.
Dude, second I saw that, I was just, he gets it.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the only thing, the only judgment you ever pass, you know what I mean, as a cardist looking down is like, he gets it, all right. Like, it's so clear when they don't get it, but like when they do, you follow them, you don't want to tell anybody else about them. You know, like, I just want to see where this goes. You know?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, especially me, because of the Best Cardist Alive. Like, I'm trying to keep everybody so quiet before they create something dope, so that like when they do, I can just be like, check this dude out, everybody. look at that guy.
Actually, perhaps we can talk a bit about Best Cardist Alive, because I definitely saw some questions, at the very least on Instagram and also on Reddit and stuff.
There's a Reddit about what?
There's a cardist subreddit.
Oh yeah, I'm on there a lot, but like, you posted about it.
Yes, I know social media ways.
Question from Kevin Carlson: can you guys start at 4 p.m. or 5 p.m.? I love this question.
Sorry, Kevin.
No, we can't.
Sadly, because of the arrow of time, it's not pointing the right direction for this. To me, I thought 6 p.m., oh, that's midnight for Europe, but that's fine. Yeah, everyone goes to bed at 2 a.m., right? That's normal. Oh, wait, no, it's not.
It's all right. This probably won't be a five-hour video. It won't be too hard to watch this when it's all said and done.
It'll be, for the record, it'll be all up on my YouTube channel. You can also watch the previous. Also, this morning, I've set up things to be able to download it. Well, I'm in the process of setting things up to be able to download these as podcasts so you could listen to them straight from iTunes or something. Still not ready yet, but I know how SoundCloud. I'm going to do it.
SoundCloud, bud. Put them on SoundCloud.
they have 180 minute limits. Pussies. If I do want to do it. So, can't handle fucking
Can't
Kevin.
Handle the content. They can't handle the
But I found another hosting thing, archive.org, which apparently will just take any file, any size. It doesn't care. It'll just do it. So next, I need to set up an RSS feed and then...
hours.
Yeah.
Damn.
And for him, it's just through the night. It started at like 1 a.m. and ended at 6 a.m.
No, the sun's up. Oh, that's what I forgot to talk about. Oh, yeah. It's supposed to be sleep. Oh.
Yeah, he took like a few Red Bulls, and apparently that was his threat.
Whatever works. Whatever
works, yeah.
Whatever. Anyway, yeah, I think I saw a couple questions about Best Cardists Alive in the comments of the Instagram post.
Yes.
You can pick one if you want. I can just ramble generally.
One of the basically the question is how do you put something up on Best Cardists Alive? What is the thought process? You were talking a bit about it, but
yeah, man. Yeah, how do we go about picking you kids?
Yeah.
How do we go about picking you kids? Well, more or less, it is basically what I described earlier, which is this idea of like, do they get it? It's like, do they get it? Do they understand what it means to have a move that has a point?
Yeah.
And at the same time, we show a bit of a bias towards the people that are creators because we love creation. We love people that create their own personal moves. Antoine put that beautifully. How he said the idea of creating a personal move.
Yes.
Is beautiful to me. I'm like, I love that wording of it. So personal moves definitely speak to us. But at the same time, we've uploaded water wheels. Much to some people's dismay. Like, why are you uploading water wheel after water wheel? I'm like, yeah, dude, thought you might like it, man. I don't know.
A lot of it is. I imagine a lot of the Best Cardists Alive thing is just also posting things that people will like. So, you know, people like water wheel.
Yeah, like, here's the thing is that it is half for you guys and half for the rest of the world. And a lot of cardists don't understand this. My goal in the beginning, I had several goals. Back when I was working at a Target, and I was just, it was like the shittiest job ever. And I was like, and I was just trying to think of like, you know, why am I bored with cardistry right now? And I was just asking my friends, like, I suggested Best Cardists Alive to so many people, and all of them were like, oh yeah, that'd be great. And then that's the end of the conversation. Yeah. I'm like, no, I want you to do it. I never wanted to be the guy that ran the page because that job sucks. I hate that. the pressure of having to be like, you know, having to put up the correct post.
Yeah, selected by
whatever.
It's like, oh man.
Oh shit. It's like, and if the guys pick something, which one goes up first?
Yeah, I imagine there's some fun logistics going on.
It's funny how like the entirety of the discourse happens through Instagram group chats and stuff like that, and it's just like it's such a sometimes silent battle of just like, oh guys, come on, we could do this. We can do this.
It sounds like you guys need to use Slack. Are you familiar with Slack?
No, I'm not. No.
Okay. It's,
no.
Slack is a great tool for communicating between teams. But anyways, yeah.
My whole thing was that what I was so concerned with in the beginning was how do we make this into something that cannot stop? Because I kept seeing who shuffles like that, the Cuso. And I was just like, why did these things stop? You know why they stopped? It's because
too much work.
It's because the guy running it just said, I can't, no more.
Yeah.
No more. No mas. And I was just like, okay, I cannot create a platform that is in essence the community itself and create it in such a way that it dies if I decide that I get bored.
Yeah.
I just don't want to do it anymore. You know, I'm like, this has to be something that I can, a system that I can construct and then give away kind of. Mm-hmm. And this is just the way that we operate now.
Yeah, yeah. Now there's what? How many of you? Five?
There's five video selectors. There's three dedicated photo selectors, which was a huge changed everything.
Yeah,
that made this page into like a fucking like that made it into this media network that was appealing to people outside of the cardistry community. Because 90% of the time when I show somebody my page, when I show them the best cards of life, they don't look at it and they start perusing videos. They scroll through the feed and the first thing they do is they click a picture.
Yeah.
The first thing they do, and I've never understood it, but they do it. Or they do it, and that's all I need to know. I just need that the photos convert so well. And the thing is that my opinion on what makes a great photo doesn't matter so much as, you know, an actual photographer. And not just any photographers, cardistry photographers. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I'm going to get some real guys that love cards and love photography and cameras. And I want those to be the opinions that you trust. You know, so that it's not like the only perk that I get for being the guy that makes the posts is that I get to pick pictures and videos. It's the only perk I ever wanted. I just like that's it. It's just because, and my only reason for that is because I get to see the numbers every day, so I feel like I have an okay idea of what makes a photo work on the page, what makes a video work on the page. It's just empirical. Just the experience of putting them up. You know? Do I know anything about photos from a technical standpoint? No, I don't know anything. All of my photos have been taken with my phone. I don't know anything. but I do kind of have a feel on what you guys like, you know, and that's it. That's all it's just that feedback. So when we talk, you know, initially it was Frankie, Chase, and myself, and I wanted to just round it out with some cool styles. You know, we didn't have someone who was great at fans or anything like that, or like their thing was fans.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to find that guy.
Yeah,
you know, it's kind of that. Yeah, very, very. You know, that niche is rare these days, and it sucks because if you want to get ahead, if you want to get ahead in this game, like there's three things that you can do. I mean, assuming this isn't stating the obvious, either you make a great cut. You just make a great cut, and everybody thinks you're like, oh, he's got a great cut. You know, you become just dope at like all of the fans.
Yeah.
Like if you just show general proficiency at all of the fans, people think you're a god.
Yeah.
They think you're a god. Or
you're pred.
Or you could do one of these ones.
Yep.
You know, you could do one of those, and you could come and like a real one. Yeah. You know, like you could make it really add something. I don't want to ever frame that like it's easy because that shit is hard.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I am not good at working with the grid, and I really respect people that are. It's incredible. Have you ever tried that? Have you ever tried to like really tried to like make an isolation? Right?
Yeah, I had. Actually, I have one ISO idea. That's it, and it's this bullshit. Which is
that's cool. What the fuck? Wait, yeah, no. All you do is get another card.
Yeah, just no. So.
And then just do that and move it around.
Actually, wait, Zui has a thing.
Yeah, bro.
There's a thing like
he's
that.
Using that, like a spin ghost.
Yeah.
You talking about, you have a move.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The thing is that the problem with it is that it's like stupid difficult. It's stupid difficult to get smooth, as in I personally can't. It's the kind of thing where I want to like hand off to someone who can do this.
You just need to get the Instagram video. You just need to get it once, bro. That's it.
Actually, I did post it on Instagram, but that was like a year ago. Yeah, hey, so man. I could probably just put it up there and then ask.
Repost, put it back up again. Yeah, man, that's funny. Isolation is one of those things.
Yeah.
But I love how I still haven't really completely answered the question. Oh wait, tell Matt we can't see him.
Oops, yeah, that's me trying to be a good cameraman and failing.
It's all right, bro. It's all right, dog. They can see me.
There you go. That's all you need.
Sup, babes.
And we look similar enough that you know they'll
So
will just mess it up. Yeah.
Both of our feeds are just the same. So when we picked, I remember this question from Shivraj. Oh. Shivraj asked, "What is the best cardist alive? What does that mean? What does it mean to be the best cardist alive, and why did I start saying that?" Mm-hmm. It started out because I was struggling to come up through other people's infrastructures. And what I mean by that, I wasn't finding much success in getting noticed by Fontaine, at least in the beginning. It just didn't feel like I was ever the first guy on somebody's list. Mm-hmm. You know, and that was really far. I wasn't a headliner at the Brooklyn con.
Yeah.
But I was just there. I was just like there. I was like, all right, whatever. No big deal. I didn't want to talk. Whatever. And I got knocked out round one in WKC and Triple C. You know what I mean? So it's just like, God damn it. Why am I so bad at cardistry? and I think it became like a bitterness that I resolved in a funny way, which is just like, you know what? I'm the best. Goddamn best. I'm just gonna start saying it because I find that people actually tightened up. It's funny because you notice how people are not comfortable with making top 10 lists in this community. We're not comfortable.
Yeah.
We're not comfortable.
I've ever seen one of those. And again, it's not something you look for, but yeah.
But it's never from a credible source too.
Oh well, yeah. Yeah.
Never. Because the politics of the community
scare
the shit out of everyone. Mm-hmm. Oh, I can't. Oh look, God forbid that I'm wrong. Yeah, God forbid that I'm wrong and I say Face is better than Maverick or whatever. You know, because that's a crime against humanity, apparently. But I was like, okay, there's this tightness, this weird analness about you know, putting yourself on top. So I'm like, I'm just gonna Kanye West this. I'm just gonna start saying I'm a god. I'm the best. I'm the best, dog. You know who I am? I'm the best. Like, you think this is a game? Like, that was, and it became like this character, like this funny persona that I, you know, every cardist that I meet up with, if I did something cool, I'd just be like, I'm so good. I'm so good. And like, you know, and then with Portable Playground 2, Kevin was just like, well, put that in the video.
Yeah.
And I'm just the best. I'm just the best. I'm the best. And then, when I was talking to Spencer, we were laughing about it. And he was just like, you the best cardist alive, man. You the best cardist alive. Like, make it fun, like best rapper alive.
Right, yeah.
And what best rapper alive means, understand this, that best rapper alive and greatest of all time are two different debates.
Of course.
Two different debates, and people don't understand this. So, like, when I best rapper alive, what that means is you're the guy – everyone's looking at. That is okay. All it means. Mm-hmm. That is all it means. It doesn't mean you're good.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you're good. It doesn't mean that your material will stand the test of time. It just means right now you're that dude that everybody's looking at. Chase, during the MB3, best cardist alive. Chase was the best cardist on the planet at that time. It was in that moment, he was the most interesting, the person everybody was looking at. So that idea, this joke of best cardist alive, is what the channel ended up being, which is that when we post you, everyone's looking at you.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah,
you're the best right now because we said you are. That's all it is. It's just because we pointed everybody at you and we're like, yeah, this guy's the shit. Look at him go. And that's all it ever was. And that, yeah. So I told I have a Facebook chat somewhere where I say to Spencer, I'm gonna make that into a brand, dude. Word of God, Spencer, I'm like, best cardist alive, BCA, is going to be a brand. He was just like, do it, pussy. You won't do it. I'm like, I will. Watch me. I was like
Spencer.
And then pretty soon after that, it was like, oh, shit, I can call this page just best cardist alive.
Yeah, it makes sense.
And I realized, I'm like, wait, this is a great idea because there's no – there is no clickbait in our community. There's no clickbait.
Yeah.
There is no like greatest cardistry ever. Incredible cardistry, hot babe tutorial. There's no none of that in this community. But I'm like, we could be that. You know, I'm like, just yeah, best cardist alive. Yeah. Yeah, we're the best. Yeah, you can't stop us because nobody in the community was saying this is the best. This is the in an official way.
Presenting
it as if it were a fact. Right. Like, yeah, it's the best. What do you mean? He's like, look at him. He's the best. and that. So I'd like to believe that I can give people that sensation of feeling like you're the guy everyone's looking at right now, you know? And at the same time, I don't want – this is a – this ties into another question that I saw, so we can move right into this.
Ooh, segue.
Yeah. Ooh, yeah. And the question was, from what I remember, it was, are you more inclined to upload people that we have not seen before?
Yes.
Versus veteran people with greater followings, and is it a point of direction of a focus of yours to feature those people? And my answer to that is that understand that I'm not featuring Darren because I think you need to see him. I'm featuring Darren because I want everyone else to see him, and it's for the record. That's all it is that in my collage of everything that is cardistry, of what cardistry means to me, it'd be kind of weird if you didn't see all the headliners.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
They are there. They're there.
They are the like, headliners for a reason.
Yeah. They're there. Like, why? I'm like, if I exclude them from my page, then that's the same problem that you get with the con, which is that, you know, people think the community is 26 people. Yeah. The community is 26 people and not this whole vibrant network of creators that are all searching for a style and all really care about what they do and this and that. And there was nowhere that communicates that.
Yeah.
So that's what this page was supposed to be. It was supposed to be a page where veterans and newcomers can coexist in a way that doesn't, you know, it's not really, you don't see the veterans as veterans. When you find the page, it's just, they're all dudes with cards. There's no politics. There's no politics on the page. So when I find a newcomer and his video's got 100 views and his video's dope, he's got 20 likes or whatever, we want to post that guy first because just from a numbers perspective, it's more effective. Yeah. Am I doing it for the sake of like, oh, I want to get that kid deserves the attention more than this guy does or whatever? No, I don't have an agenda. You know, I am not on a mission to you know, dish out even recognition. I'm on a mission to create the best cardistry page.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And to do that, right, I have to appeal to cardists as well. And what appeals to cardists are new cardists, is new cardistry. Whereas for the rest of the world, they don't give a fuck. They just love cardistry.
Yeah.
They eat it up. And more importantly, magicians love it. Magicians love it.
Interesting.
Magicians. Here, okay. I got to say, the one thing that every brand right now is doing wrong is that we're still following this model of fuck magicians. We don't need them. We don't need them. It's because we're all kind of coming off that like collective resentment, right? Of like, yeah. Oh, you didn't believe in us. You didn't want us. Yeah. Bro, we don't want you either. Blah, blah, blah. Like, it's this whole hostile negativity. Just like, nah, we don't need them. Listen, they are our sister community. Their infrastructure is a part of our infrastructure, meaning I can triple the size of my audience if I make a page that they like. And here's the thing is that magicians, 9 out of 10 times, like cardistry. They just don't like looking for cardistry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're like, who wants to go? They wouldn't follow me. They wouldn't follow like me and like all my other friends. No, they'll follow the Great Danes and the Verts and Dior's Grip, and they'll feel done.
Yeah,
I've done my part. I like some cardistry from time to time. Yeah, of course. You know, just because if you don't, you're honestly kind of weird.
Some of my best friends are cardists. What are you talking about?
Yeah. You're like, I'm not racist. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? I've done a Sybil before. I've given it a chance. But this is the page where they can be almost completely informed. And it's like, yeah, there you go. Sure. Just follow my page. I'll give you the gist of it.
Yeah.
Fine. I'll give you the gist of it. I know you guys want to watch. I know. You just don't want to fill your feed with it.
Yeah.
That's fine. I'll do it. That's the point of the page. Is it's just supposed to give people an occasional dose of what we're up to. It's not really meant to be this thing that's like, let's bring up the people that don't have audiences that are big enough and let's give them and bring – it's not about that. It's about making the coolest page that we can make because nobody's done it.
Yeah.
Amazingly, that nobody's done this. And then at the root of it is that I really wanted this page. From my – perspective as a cardist, it's very bittersweet being the guy that has to run the page because I just wanted to play. You know what I mean? I just wanted to play the game and try to get featured. And it's funny because notice how I said Dimitri got me into cardistry and Aviv changed my mind. He blew my mind. Notice how they're both on my team.
Yeah.
I got those two guys. Yeah. Yeah, sure. That was what I wanted. I wanted to create a page that I know I wanted, therefore others will have wanted it as well. And I know that you create your best material when you're creating it to accomplish something. Mm-hmm. And this is the thing that you can accomplish. You know what I mean? There aren't really any goals to be had in this community outside of like have a DVD, create a video that everybody likes, create a move that everybody does, make a deck of cards, do something with a popular brand of cardistry. That's it, man.
Yeah.
That's it. That's the game. That's all you can do. What about you? Like, did you have any goals like that you could say, like, were you motivated by an objective at all, or is that just me?
No. So there's, there was the ICO, which was a pretty artificial but effective motivator, obviously, and it worked really well.
The ICO. That's totally right. Yeah.
That was.
God, I totally forgot about that.
why did I not do that? That's weird.
It was surprisingly, I have to say, it wasn't run exceedingly well. There were a couple issues with it. Like, for example,
they're never run well. There hasn't been a single competitive event that I haven't had some problem with infrastructure. But we can talk about that after this. you get into that. You get into your little spill.
But yeah, ICO was interesting because I don't know. I didn't plan on winning like at all. What happened is that I thought that I would get through the first two rounds and then get kicked out, and you know, I'd be cool because I would have done some videos. Because part of it is that I felt like I was missing some motivation to make just good videos. And that really helped and also gave me a lot of experience for future videos. But yeah, and so just having to like make something every 10 days basically meant that, you know, I had to go overclock myself in terms of both not only just being able to make videos but also making material, because, you know, no one has material for four rounds of a competition.
Yeah.
So we didn't at plan. All. He had like two rounds worth and have just created everything else.
I have such a problem with that. I have such a problem that you're forced to create strategically.
Yeah, that's an issue.
It's so annoying, man. Let me check out this chat. I like totally forgot there was even a chat. Wow.
Yeah, people what? Are we have 36 viewers, by the way.
Yeah.
Which is pretty cool.
Woo! 36 yeah. Woo. All right. Hey, Spencer was here for like half a second. What's good, B? What's good, B? How you doing? We got Andrew Avila for like, yeah. Buddy, we got Matt Fox, hate you. Scott Black wants to see your isolation, no surprises.
Yeah, that's why I was.
Oh my god. Wait, what is happening? You guys are just. Yo, Patch, what it do? About to start. Spencer heard the shout out. Yeah, Spencer heard my shout out. Okay, all right. Shout out time is over. They want to see Gizmo. They want to see my move, Gizmo. It's not even that good.
It's pretty.
It's the best cut ever. It's the best cut. It's the best cut, guys. Guys, what is the? Let me just stand up. Let me just stand up while I do this. Oh,
ooh.
That is the four. Oh,
I feel like Gizmo is a perfect name for this.
This is like this is my Nimbus. This is my goddamn Nimbus right now. Just a little ball of stuff that happens, and it's
It's effective. That's another word that I like using.
Effective. Oh, did you see? You saw my post on that, dude. Did you see my two posts where I said
yes. Effective and not effective. That's probably why.
Oh, I need to talk about this because people commented. They're like, "What are you? This is effective. What are you talking about?" No. Y'all don't understand what effective means. Effective means how good is it at getting you from A to B? How good is it at getting the job done?
Yeah.
You know, Dropbox is effective.
Oh yeah.
That move that I said was not effective is not particularly good at doing a something. You know what I mean? It's not like it just you can say like, oh, that's a great move. It's a great cut. That's a great X display. That's a great aerial. No, it's just like a weird jumble cardistry.
It's an eyebrow razor, I would say, because there's some like things where you're like, oh, all right.
More, I call it a flex cut in that it's mainly designed to show you that I'm smart. That's all it is. It's just supposed to show you, look at this mechanic and this mechanic and that, and I can just do it all and blah.
Yeah.
And veterans will love it because they'll be able to take it apart and eat it and like really consume it and spit out pieces of it in what they do. Problem is that
lots of people won't be able to tell me why it's good.
Yeah.
That's the thing. The other – and the move's kind of hard, and I spent a lot of time making it.
Mm.
That's not effective. Mm-hmm. You know, the analogy I came up with is I was just like Rapunzel with short hair probably looks really hot, but she totally is not good for the job, like the actual yeah. job of like – like that's not effective. Oh my god, but this chat, what is the dude? No, teach Gizmo. Yeah, when can we get Pat? They just is freaking awesome. Talk about effective. Why? Just to show you that I'm smart. Yeah, man. Fairy tale analogies all day. Spencer Clark getting it. Holding it down for me. Spencer Clark in the chat. Everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Dude, I'd love to teach you guys Gizmo, but I have no idea how. I can't teach a move without holding the camera with my mouth. I just don't know how to do it.
Have you considered a tripod?
No, no, too easy.
Yeah, no, that's dumb.
Here's funny. I've been getting tagged everywhere. People be like filming like Patch Bar, filming like Patch Bar, and they show me. I got tagged like 5 times this month. You know, and people like, and I love it. I think it's great. It's not my idea, guys. I didn't. Let me tell you what happened with it. Like, as all great ideas happen, I stole it. You know what I mean? I totally stole it. I'm pretty sure the first guy that I saw do this was Oliver. What I added to it, the difference between what Oliver does and what I do, is that Oliver, he kind of used it as a way to be his own tripod. You know what I mean? That's the best way to put it, is he just kind of holds the phone there, does the move, doesn't have a tripod, perfect, you know?
Yeah.
My idea was like, oh, shit, you could just be your own cameraman and to actually, like, move my head like around the thing. Well, I've done so many cuts like this. Like, you have no go to my account and like watch those videos and realize that I never have a cameraman.
You know, you realize that, in the background.
Yeah, bro, it's so funny. Like, I got all this panning action. Like, it's like a third hand, dude. It's like part of the cut. I'm dead ass. Like, you're laughing, but I'm like,
yeah,
that's real to me. Put the camera in your mouth now. Let me see. Pat, do you still do Dime? Oh my god, do you? Oh, do I do Dime? Let me talk about Dime for a second. I gotta say, I think I don't feel guiltier about anything I've ever done in this community than I do about Dime, because I got Dime is like 95%. I mean, like actually, like 95% Bass John's move. I'm not exaggerating. Like, all of the move is, I think I added like one spin and I like convinced myself that it was my move and I put it on the wire and like I even credited him. I even credited him. Guys, don't credit me for that move. Like, just that is all Bass. That is Bass John's. That is his intellectual property. I hate that people even call it Dime.
Yeah.
I hate it, bro. I hate it, because that is just not my idea. But don't steal shit, kid. Oh, this is a great topic.
Oh,
this is a great topic. Yeah. What? Yeah, yeah. What constitutes stealing in a bad way? What is unhealthy stealing? Because I always say, dude, just take it. Just say, just steal that. You can steal that. Just take. Just it's so. They don't understand what I'm trying to say, though, because it's the word steal.
Yeah.
You know, you guys, yeah. Remember, you guys, you know the book, Steal Like an Artist? I know Kevin Ho must have You must have talked to Kevin Ho at least a billion times about the book Steal Like an Artist. You ever heard of that?
Yeah.
Oh, beautiful book talking about this subject. And the idea is, I want to, at least in a cardist context, when you steal from another cardist, you cannot steal the cool part and the structure of their move. Ooh, you can steal the cool part or the structure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, here's an example. Here, two moves that share the same cool part: Spin Doctor and Jaspis Display.
Right.
They are moves that do the same thing but are mechanically very different, so they can stand on their own.
Yeah.
You know, if your move accomplishes the same purpose and it's structurally the same, you are a thief. And you suck. So that's when stealing becomes unhealthy. When your move does not accomplish, it can't be called yours. There's no real reason for it to exist. You know, Jaspis Display has a place because it's mechanically very different from, it's a different answer to the same problem.
Yes. Yeah.
That's how I'm going to look at it. You can look at the problem that they answered and say, okay, I want to answer that question too. I want to move like that as well. But you cannot say, I want an X cut and then do this.
Yeah.
You just can't, because the structure and the purpose is still biases. You just can't do that. Yeah. So yeah. Yeah. You stop. Don't steal shit. But steal everything. But steal everything you see, because it makes life so much easier. let me see. Do you still do Penny Royal? Yeah, I fucking love Penny Royal. Penny Royal is my jam, bro. Penny Royal is my jam, dude. I can't even do it, probably, but like, first try. Oh, wow, he's so good at cards. Perfect. Aviv just told me that he can anti-Pharaoh, but he can't do trigger. So there's hope for all of you. oh my god. Best cards alive. Thanks, man. Talk about the talented NY. Matt, if you were here, you know that I mentioned Billy Markowitz. That was the first thing I did. First thing I did right out the gate was like, yo, Billy. Said, this dude Matt reminds me of Billy. And Billy, if you don't know Billy, Billy is the Noel Heath of interlock packet cutters. He is an interlocker. I've never seen anybody he's just an interlocker. Like, damn, dude.
Yeah.
Like, do you think you're a niche card? Like, would you describe yourself as being somebody that has a niche? Or are you would you call yourself a packet cutter?
Yeah. Yeah. I think, if anything, I would call myself a thematic packet cutter, if that makes any sense.
You know what? Music has got some crazy complex name for genres. So whatever you got to call it.
I mean,
I think I make
cuts that have that are particularly strong in the sense that they have a theme that carries throughout. Maybe that's just, I don't know.
No, I do. Yeah.
The very least, that's the cuts that I've noticed people like that I make. So perhaps that's a good way to gauge that.
Antoine put it that way. He said that my goal with making a cut is to encapsulate a concept.
Yes.
Yeah. And I'm like, that feels like what you're saying to me now. It's that, you know,
a bit different. Yeah, there's some subtleties that I can't quite put my, well, I can't quite describe what I mean, but it's that idea. Yeah.
Yeah. Like the idea of having like, you search for purpose first.
Yes.
Is what you're, okay. All right. Yeah. Cause I mean, I know some people favor the mechanical approach. It's actually really interesting that people differ so much on this.
Yeah.
You know, especially Shivraj, you know, Shivraj and Aviv create in a very similar way. Mm-hmm. And Shivraj has packet cuts. He does. Yeah.
He's good ones too. Love his packet cuts.
Dude, when I see Shiv, I see very much like what I was trying to do, which is just I want to do all of it. I want to do like the Aviv thing with packet cutting. That's it. That's how I honed in on it. You know, he has always been like adamant about the fact that you can't control the process. It's not something that should be deliberate. It's something that it's total organic creation, you know, and as you can see, he wrote that article exploring mechanics.
Yeah.
You know, and that actually got me out of a rut, seriously, because like I had been in a place where I had run out of cool parts. I'd run out of purposes.
Right.
You know, it's kind of hard. It's kind of hard to just dream up a purpose.
Yeah.
But then I read his article and I'm like, oh shit, I forgot that that's how everybody starts out. Everybody starts out just looking, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm like, oh great. I needed that article. I really did. Yeah. I don't know. Like that totally got me back on the right track. We look at these, Pats, did you steal any other moves? Nah, I haven't. I can't say that there's any other move that is just like straight up not mine. You know what I mean? Like that. Like that. That move is like, hell yeah. Dime is like just like worlds not mine. Like that is just best God's move, man. This is tough because I steal a lot. I just don't steal like I try to steal respectfully. You know what I mean? I try to like actually contribute to things, but I don't know. Yeah, I don't think I've still like overtly stolen anything other than that. Thoughts on variations? Thoughts on variations. My thoughts on variations. Well, I think that a lot of people suck at them because we haven't quite arrived at a point yet as a community where we totally understand like what it means to have a variation. I actually, this is true actually. And this ties into what this other kid is saying. He said, do your 5-packet one-handed cut. And I won't do a 5-packet one. I have a 4-packet thing. And the 4-packet, I think, is it like this one? Like that? That one. And it is a combination of flat iron, plinko, and flip flop, and it was funny because I created that cut for a variations contest, and my thinking was that it's a flat iron variation and a plinko variation,
right?
but the problem is that it is a combination of flat iron and plinko and flip flop, so it's like more of a combo. And I'm like, and I put that cut out, and then I lost that contest. And then Tobias makes a combo contest, and I'm like, you guys are just, oh my god, you guys are just dicking me now, because I made a dope combo. I was this close to submitting a variation for that combo. That one was so funny. That was so funny if I submitted like just a variation of the combo kata. I think variations definitely have their place. In that, my problem is that it's very hard for me to figure out exactly what constitutes a variation in this community, just because I can't really think of many. You know what I mean? it's like most of the time, variations end up being a new move.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's kind of relates to what you were saying before about how, you know, if you're stealing, you should be stealing. You shouldn't only be stealing structure or form. And if you're doing a variation, you're basically kind of stealing.
You're modifying the structure. You're taking the structure and the cool part with modifications to the structure.
Yeah.
But it's – oh, wait. No, I do have one variation. I do. I have my canvas variation. The way you open canvas is like that. You open canvas, you kick like this. And I was never a huge fan of the opener, only because it was difficult. And I like that. And And he was saying that this is uncomfy cardistry, and I'm just like, no, it isn't. It's just that opener. So my variation was that. You know what I mean? And you just go right into it.
Right.
And we were talking about flow of energy earlier, mm-hmm. and this is a great example of this. It was purely constructed off flow of energy. This goes to here, which yep. then brings this around to here, scoops that around to here. It's very, very clear the flow of energy in yeah. that cut. With this, it's not so obvious. The flow of energy is that. It's it's just this. Is this idea of that. And I understand that that's what he was going for. I actually didn't understand that when I made that variation. I respect his opener. I just think that this accomplishes a very similar sort of effect.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it has a very logical flow of energy in and of itself. So that, yeah, I do think that variations have their place. I forgot that I even had one. If you find that you have an edit to their structure, but you have to say that it's a variation. You can't just say that, you know, because like the problem is that some things should not be changed.
That's
like,
the thing.
For example, do not do a Charlier at the end of Squeeze. That's fucking stupid. That's stupid. It's stupid. Don't do that. It's not. That is not a variation. That is you doing the move wrong.
It sounds like what you're saying, and what I agree is that variations are more like an improvement, if not a slight personal spin on a cut. Because hypothetically, if a cut is good enough, then it's at its peak, and so you know if you modify it and do variations on it, you're not really improving it. And if you're modifying it enough, then you're just making a different cut.
Yeah. Do you actually add something? You know what I mean? Is there a reason? Do you have an actual purpose? You know?
Yeah.
Let me see, please. Wait, I'm reading these. Talk about BCA. I already did that, man. Keep that shit. Let me see. Yeah, you guys are funny. it's this kid talking about my well, he calls that a variation. I call that a combo. There's this combo. This is the best combo I made. Just this to Maverick to flip flop to flip phone. It's a Frankenstein. It's just a bunch
right,
of
yeah.
pieces that come together to make this thing. Problem is that every single moment in this move doesn't really belong to me. There's not really much mechanical variations there. It's more just like
it's a combo.
It's a combo.
Yeah, it's like I have this in the same vein. Of course, I'm not going to be able to do it, but that's fine.
Of course, you will. First try.
I do squeeze into VBH, but I do the transition before doing the.
Kill him.
So.
Kill him. Kill him, Matt. Ah! Ah! Wait, there you go. I'll be right. I'm going to turn the lights on.
All right, yeah. But yeah, so the variation. It's more the combo aspect is that I do the transition into VBH before doing the
it's just revolution. A little thing.
Yeah, it's just a little thing, and it's just because I don't know.
Let me see. What would you call a variation of your move your own? I would call it my variation.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's not my move. It doesn't make the move mine, but it's my version of the move. So it's a way for me to own a piece of it.
Yeah.
You know,
and I wouldn't make a tutorial on it.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely not. You would show them that and then hope they teach it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, that's the best thing that you can hope for. The combo opener is tailor-made. It's tailor-made into Maverick, into flip flop, into flip phone. And that's probably the best. That's probably the best combo that I'd say. I mean, it's because as the chat said, it is a combo that looks like a flourish.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's fun.
it's fun.
If you could do that, you know. What are some of your favorite unoriginals? Ooh, I fucking love this one. Yeah, because I steal all the time. So like all I ever get to do is look at other people's shit and just be like, please, I wish I had one of those, or if I could just take it.
Yeah.
Nimbus is just like, boy, like Nimbus is like the first time that like not only did I not understand it, I couldn't do it even when I was watching the tutorial. Just couldn't. Oh, what? Look at that. Look at this move. Look at this man's move. Do you understand how perfect this fucking flourish is? Do you understand? hang on a minute. Oh my god. Oh my god. That's so good. I think I saw somebody say, what are your thoughts on Hispanic cardists? I fucking love them. I love the South American cardistry community. I want to do a tour there super badly because nobody has gone there.
Yeah. I think that don't hear about them at all.
No, I would love to go to South America. I think the Russians are tits. The Russians are up. The Russians are like, damn, dude.
It was really cool meeting them in Berlin.
Oh, we were there.
Yeah.
Dude, how were they? Were they like, they were tits, right?
It was really funny because they really had like a mafioso vibe, like really strong. Yeah.
That makes me so happy. No, I saw that. I think it was Euro. He did the deck padil to foot catch. Just did it live. No big deal. And
yeah.
He just caught it. His face is just like.
Yeah.
We do this every day. and it's snowing all the time. No big deal.
Yeah, they wanted people and were like, "Oh, show me this move." And I don't know.
Oh yeah.
And they had a live performance, which was pretty crazy.
Oh really? How was that?
It was pretty.
What did they do? They had like a same. They had like a whole routine.
Yeah, they had a whole routine. They went all out and went like arm spread catches and stuff like that. And yeah, it's ballsy. Not something I would ever do.
That's the shit, though. Like that's what's up.
Yeah, I didn't.
That's some real flexing, though. That's like.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
We can really do cardistry, pussies. Yeah, we just use Instagram because we need to. But like, just because we got to get the word out somehow.
yeah, I did one uncut, and that's good enough for my entire career.
yeah.
I'm glad I never have to do that again.
Lacoste one or two? Lacoste one or two, man. This is tough, man. Like Lacoste two is a smarter cut. Lacoste one looks better.
Hmm.
Yeah. All right, there we go. Let me see. Are squids good? Squids are the shit, dog. Like, squid.
Yeah.
Squids are just the bee's knees. You gotta understand that cards suck for a lot of reasons, and that's just what. It's what I've used for so long now. But here's the thing is if I want to go for a walk, like in the forest or whatever, just go for a walk, right? I'm not bringing my $40 cards. You know what I mean? I'm not even bringing my $10 cards.
Yeah.
Cards, dude, that sucks. You get any dirt on your hands, doesn't work. If it's raining, doesn't work. Dude, I can use squids in the shower.
Wait, I need to try that.
You understand exactly because you didn't think about the possibility. You could just
dude, shower thoughts, but for cardistry. Oh my god,
you could just be in the shower, man. You could be like, and nothing can stop you now. You could be antisocial and weird anywhere you go now. You could just be
at last.
You can develop incredible muscle memory. Kevin talked about this in the live stream. You talked about how once you get the muscle memory here, yep, neural pathways are formed, and you can translate it over to this object.
And one thing I noticed is that also because of their very nature, you don't have to deal with packets being square and stuff, obviously. But what that means is that you can also practice doing cuts with an exceedingly light grip, which can be really helpful in terms of getting smoother.
Hell yeah. And you can, and if your cut is if you make a mistake with a cut, you can fix it mid cut as opposed to having to drop everything and you're just like, oh well, I'm bad. I'm just bad. What's up? What are you doing?
Hey.
My dog wanted attention. Look, Congressman community. Demetri's got a cat. I've got a dog. All right, get out of here. Get out of here, sweetie. I got
business to attend.
Get out of here, bitch. oh man.
In terms of and actually for this flippy cut, which I haven't quite found a name for yet.
Let me see. Bro. To and fro.
You know, actually I wanted to call it
To and fro.
Well, yeah. So I like the idea of like Pandora's box, but I can't really do that because that's kind of taken.
That cut is so freaking good, dude. Ask the chat. What should he call that move? Chat,
all right, give me some tips.
Answer that question. Do it.
Also considered calling it Berlin or something because there's like a wall in the middle and you know.
That means the move just like falls apart mid. let me see. What about Squall? Yeah, Squall is incredible. It's an incredible
Squall is like a perfect move.
Yeah, Squall is exactly what he said it was. He said it, everything that he wanted it to be. Yeah, call it Trump because of the wall. Oh. Yeah, I might feature that comment on best comments.
Man, I would just feel bad during the tutorial. I'll be like, all right, guys, this is...
I feel you, Matt. Pussy. it wasn't Matt that said that. It was Shuffler6900 that said it first. There you go. Credit where it's due. all right. What other questions do I want? What else do we want to get at today? What else we got? Oh man. Yo, Best Cardist Live is so cool.
Yeah, it's
so cool. It's so much fun. Like whenever I see, you know, somebody comment, you know, on their own repost, like, dude. Yes.
Yeah,
man. I'm just like, yeah, you go, kid. Yeah. Yeah, you're the shit right now. You're better than me right now. You are. You know what I mean? That's how I want it to feel. I want it to feel like a victory.
Yeah.
You know, I want it to feel like I did it. I won. I won cards. Let me see. Oh, yeah, wait, these kids are asking questions.
Oh, questions. All right.
Matt, can you give some tips on your hot damn Ernest running idea?
Ooh.
Bro, your shit with – I didn't even talk about this. You're a beast with this fucking dude. Like, if I could do that with squids, like, perfectly, just boom, boom, bitches, come at me. Like, it's so cool looking, like – Yeah, no, but it looks so dope. Cause you
yeah,
like
the continuous Astley. One is just... It, yeah.
You look like Rick Astley. Yeah,
that sounds like an Instagram post I need to make.
That's incredible. That's the best. And you even... I'm pretty sure you had a brown jacket on in the Ernest video. Like,
yeah.
Just
yeah.
Like Rick Astley.
Fuck. Yeah.
Matt is Rick Astley. Oh, Matt is Rick
Astley. cool, I guess.
Oh my god. Hang on,
Ernest go around tips. So one thing, if you want to do continuous Ernest go arounds, first of all, practice just throwing them on a bed or something, And the thing that's hard when you first start is that when you learn the ordinance go around, you want to relax your hand to catch the cards. The only thing is that you can't relax your hands between things. So basically, I do the toss, but I stay in the exact same grip. I'm gonna cameraman this. Oh, there you go. Yeah. So I just stay in the same grip and just practice being able to peel packets fast enough. And so it's actually kind of hard with squids because they don't bend.
Yeah, that's true.
So,
you're right about that. We gotta work on that. We'll get Chase to fix that.
So there's that. Also, when you do the grip, put your index kind of as far as possible to the ends, and then pull back with your index to get as much spin as possible. Because the spin, first of all, looks awesome, but also stabilizes the packet and makes it easier to deal with. Yeah. The only downside to having it spin more is that then when you catch it, you can catch in awkward positions. After cardisting on, I was like, all right, I'm done with Ernest Gura and tired of it. I came up with another thing, which is, the problem with Erdnay's go-around is that it has this weird grip, right? And so if you want to continue going and actually just continue juggling, you're screwed because you need to re-grip. So I found a way to, I do a few Erdnay's go-arounds, continuous, then I do a double in this hand, which gives me the time to re-grip in the other hand. And keep going.
Oh, dude, that's so wow! That's dirty. I did it. You know what I mean? Like for you, like that's you can have a floating cards out of that, like a whole routine, kind of like boom.
And awesome. Yeah, and there's a couple things you can like. Maybe I should do something like an actual tips video where I talk about all of the different things I did in the Erdnay's go around. There's also that thing, which is interesting in a couple ways.
I gotta cut in real quick. I don't know if they actually saw your isolation. I just saw the comments.
Yeah.
At the top
I showed it earlier, but I couldn't show it again just for the records.
Spencer's totally. Well, I love you, Spencer. I fucking love you, Spencer, dude. I'm just like, ooh. Look at it. That totally, you could totally do something dope with that. You just have to
fucking.
You don't have to spin ghost it. You got to spin ghost it. Just like, yeah. You just gotta have something that you can just change.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Woo. Oh yeah, dude.
Yeah.
For sure. Never gonna keep you. Thank you, Mighty Kimchi, for chiming in there. Do I see cardistry as a type of dance? Or a separate performance art.
Interesting. I've never heard that before.
Separate performance art. I look at it. The best description of cardistry I can come up with is it is skateboarding mixed with pen spinning.
Mm-hmm. All right.
It is the culture and the sort of workings of skateboarding in that we really do operate very similarly in terms of how we distinguish ourselves, our infrastructure, stylistically. I said, the verts. We have verts.
Yeah.
We do have vert skaters. We do.
Zach was talking about how he stole a lot of the marketing stuff just from skateboarding.
Yep. The best way to look at a packet cut is a flip trick. It's a flip trick. And that is why packet cuts don't necessarily appeal to everybody, because when you see a skateboarder do a really complex flip trick, what is objectively what you see is the guy rides the skateboard, he pops, and then a bunch of shit happens underneath his feet, and then he lands. You know? to the untrained eye, that's what happened.
Yeah.
So if you do seven of them in a row, you're like, yeah, dude, yeah, all right, yeah. He can do that. You know? that's why people tend to appreciate vert skaters more, or street skaters. You know, look into Mark Gonzalez if you want to be just blown away by, like, because Mark Gonzalez, I compared. I said Tobias is our Mark Gonzalez, at least in the sense that he's the first guy that I've ever seen that instead of just doing a combo, he creates a full line, like a full sequence in what I would call like how a skater would do it, in that he just flows through moments. And like I've never seen somebody that just does cardistry in that way. He's not the one that invented that, but he is definitely the best I've seen at it, for sure. So yeah, I compare it more to a cross between certain subcultures, but let me see. I love this kid. This dude Griff is like, what is your creative process? And then Adam Sharp is just like, you already talked about that, Griff. let me see. Yeah, man. What do I want to talk about?
Gabriel Ong asked if I can piddle. I just real quick. Gabriel Ong asked if I can piddle. Nope. Not like at all.
Yeah.
I cannot. No.
I don't really see a point. For me, you know what the piddle is in skateboarding? It's the manual.
Hmm.
How long can you manual? If you do it for 7 seconds, you've already communicated that you could do it.
Actually, so the thing is, the only reason I would ever want to learn how to piddle, which I don't really, I didn't pick it up like quickly. I'm like, whatever. The only thing is that I have this, this card toss, which is interesting.
What? What are you doing? Wait, what are you doing?
Wow. So because I have this card toss, I feel like it would be really cool to just do this into a piddle. But I can't piddle, so, you know, too bad.
Right. Nobody's judging you except all the people watching.
I'll teach the – this is another one of those where I'll teach the thing and then say, okay, now someone better at piddling can do the transition to piddling, and it'll be fine. It'll exist. That's good enough for me.
Woo! Woo! How do you feel about, like, nuance changes, like the difference between this moment – like, see, this to here, right? So I have, okay, eyes and whip, right? I've been doing this, right, for the longest time now. I've been doing that. There's that version of it, and then there's this one where instead you bring it around the back.
Oh.
You, at a certain point, do you think changes like that really matter?
Because yes.
Does it actually get – does it get in the way of the moment that's being communicated, do you think? Is this? That's the new moment, I think. Is there? You know what I mean? Instead of this moment. You know what I mean? It does look very different, even though you are accomplishing like the same thing.
Yeah.
So, have you ever run into a moment where you've like struggled with, you know, something as nuanced as that, that you're just like, I can't eat what? This doesn't matter. Does it really matter? You know.
Yes, actually. So one thing that's kind of similar is what I like to call like cardistry tai chi. So it's the idea that, you know, you have when you're doing something like, I don't know, squeeze. Both your hands are moving back and forth, and the cut just stays in the same area. What happens if you like keep one hand in place? So in this case, my right hand is not moving, right? And it looks a bit different. Squeeze isn't a very good example. A better example is this cut.
I saw this the other day. Yeah, dude, that little closer. That's dirty.
Yeah. Basically, the move is about the closer.
No, honestly, I see this. That part. This thing, when you go like that.
Yeah. The thing that everyone points out is, oh, man, that closer. I think the move is a bit more identity than just the closer, but that's the mechanically interesting part, at least.
Yeah, the cliff, exactly. I mean, actually, speaking of mechanics, somebody just said, I'll direct this at both of us, mechanical or comfy cardistry?
Oh, actually, that's something I've been running into recently. I've been, for the past couple of months, I've been consciously trying to do things that are just mechanically more complicated, just kind of as an exercise. Because the thing with something Sisyphus, is that it's
such a funny name.
So the thing with something Sisyphus is that although it's really it's effective, as you said, like it's not really fulfilling just from a mechanical perspective. It's not exceedingly difficult. So I don't know. That's just one of those personal things that I have. A lot of value in having things that are comfy. Just, I think that currently I'm in a period where I'm trying to do things that are probably more complicated than you need to be. This thing is really hard.
I'd say it really depends on your objective. Again,
yep, coming absolutely.
Are we trying to create practical cardistry? Dealers Grip specializes in practical cardistry.
Yeah.
They create cardistry very economically. And once you get better at creation, you'll start to understand really what I mean by that. It's like the decisions you make, if you're trying to think, all right, I want to make a move I can sell, that's a totally different way of thinking.
Flip phone, the most marketable move that has ever been.
I should have won. Tobias, you know I should have won. Weren't even trying with flip phone. I know you're lazy. Our flip phone, the name flip phone.
It's perfect.
The name flip phone as a package, it is a perfect move.
It's the perfect marketing.
The name lends itself to the move more so than just about any other name I've ever seen.
Yeah, no, it's
Prince Charming is the most clever, like funny, like, you know, deep name.
Yeah. So,
but flip phone is just like, dude, flip it's phone.
I wouldn't
have understood it until I heard the name.
Yeah, it actually is part of the experience of the cut.
That's how strong the name is.
Yeah.
It's like, wow, good for you. Like, good for you, man. Talk about your vid and deck of the year, conspiracy, the verts. There's a deck of the year conspiracy. What?
Who knows?
Well, Pat, talk about your vid and deck of the year conspiracy with the verts. Where is Throne Alone? Throne Alone sucks, Leo. I'm sorry. I didn't do well with Throne Alone. I'll come back with a better project. Talk about your vid and deck of the year conspiracy. I don't have a conspiracy. There's no conspiracy going on here.
I mean, it's pretty straightforward. The verts are just on point.
The only thing I'll say is I think their deck and their video were beautifully timed. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm going to say about it.
That's part of it, yeah.
Nothing else to say about that.
I have to say, I wasn't a fan of the awards in general. I don't know.
I wish there was more categories. I wish that the voting happened in a different way. But it's like, what can you do? I'm all about dishing out recognition. That's what my channel does right now. And I can appreciate giving a kid a trophy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Cool.
Oh, yeah, yeah, sure, yeah.
Very nice. You know what I mean? I love that. Verts equals triangle. V plus Patrick is Illuminati. Hi, Garrett. What's up, man? How you doing, Garrett? Barolo 2 is bae. You right. Barolo 2 is bae. I agree. Lap dance is the shit. Lap dance is the shit, dude. I got to say, lap dance, bro, you want a good squid move? Lap dance for sure. Because when I was out in Chicago, we were testing out a lot of material on people, just strangers. And the thing I found myself doing a lot, I was doing Dropbox a lot, just because Dropbox is fully compatible with squids. Which is just so convenient. Lap dance, because you can do it on your leg or on their hand.
Oh,
you haven't seen that yet? Have you not, dude? You haven't seen me do that on some. Bro, where have you been, man? Where have you been? Yeah, man. Lap dance on the hand is probably one of the greatest ideas that I have, because it's the only move, as far as I know, that's designed to be held. Yeah. And there's a really interesting subtlety that I got from Kaylin Morelli. I think this is Kaylin. It's either Kaylin's or Chase's, but I know Kaylin was there for this. Where it was like the idea of is that, yeah, I think this is Chase's idea. Yeah, where it's like you hit the bottom of their hand as you do it. And that creates a touch response around the hand. And you can feel the move. It like tickles the middle, and then it moves the hand up, and
right.
then it all. And then most importantly, there's this moment, that moment of success that we get to experience. They never get to feel that. They get to feel that, and then and it lands in dealer's grip, and they're just like. What? And in that moment, they know they're not magnets. They know there's no. It's just these blocks. It's like, wow. Give me a lap dance. Oh, you know how I do. You need a lap dance, Carter. Sure, you can feel. Yeah, you gave so many lap dances at the meetup, man. I did. That sounds so filthy, but I did. Who are your favorite underground cardists?
Ooh.
I love the Italians. I think the Italians are definitely incredible. Alex Ricci. Alex, I think that's how you say his name. His name on Instagram, it's ALXRCC, I think is his name.
Oh, yes. I believe. Yeah.
He's got some real, real grit, that guy. He's got some serious moves, that guy. Let me see. Pat, what do you think about Lotharinha? I think I'm saying that right. I think it's a great cut. I could have definitely pictured myself making that cut, honestly. I think it's beautifully constructed. I think the closer makes sense. I loved every iteration of that cut. And I'm pretty sure that the guy that made that cut was the first person that I ever featured on Best Cardist Alive. So I got some sentimentality for that guy. You know what I mean? Let me see. Re-upload the Throne Alone trailer. And I'm like, I just feel wet. I actually feel bad because Jamie Tischer did a great job editing that. Whatever. Milo. I feel like I know this dude, Milo. I gotta look for you right now because I want to say I saw you do something cool. Milo, have I featured you? I feel like I've definitely featured you. Or at least I'm like watching you. I don't remember. I don't remember, but I'm probably paying attention to you. So, good job. Pat, please make your own website. Sell all your material. I buy everything. Bruh, I got some big stuffs on the way.
Ooh.
We can't talk about any of that, but ooh. it's some big stuffs. Some big stuffs, and I think that you guys are going to be stoked about it. And, Pocket Park Best Cardist Alive is a part of Pocket Park.
Interesting.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know this.
Yeah, no, I didn't realize.
Thing is that it was just easier to do it that way. Chase and I for the longest time, ever since San Diego, like CardistryCon, MagicCon, San Diego.
Yeah.
2014. No, or 2013. I don't even remember. I think it might have been 2013. Ever since that, I knew that Chase was going to be, I was going to work with Chase. Like Chase is going to be the guy because he is the only other guy I felt like I really like just clicked with. Like he got what I was going for sure, And, Pocket Park is already a business. They're already a business, And I constructed Best Cardist Alive to be something that would eventually go to some business. And I would just be a part of that. So I am the media section of Pocket Park, basically. It's all under that company. But we've got some crazy shit.
Sounds good.
We got some crazy shit. You don't even know we got some crazy shit. Patch is a freaking monkey. I'm a freaking monkey, man. Move monkeys, bro.
Oh, that's a thing you don't hear every day.
Pat, opinion on Curly Q fan. I love the Curly Q. I think the Curly Q, I much prefer the Curly Q over Padiddle. If that has to be the fad, fine. Like, fine, man. I mean, I featured that Mad.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah, I featured his
her.
Her. What? That's a girl?
I believe so.
You're a girl? No way.
Someone else.
Yeah, no, you're not. No, you're not. No, you're not.
I'm not sure.
What? I gotta look at this right now. I gotta look at this right now. There's no way. There's no way. I thought you just had long as fuck hair. You a chick? Because if you, I mean, whatever. You can do a dope. You do a dope curly cue. Mad's a girl. Yeah. That's so funny. No,
I could be wrong.
He's in the chat. He's in the chat. Word. Yeah, him. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, all right. I'm definitely thinking of someone else.
All right, all right. Word.
My bad. Word. Sorry.
Fuck you, man. Oh my god.
All right. In case you don't like me, Mads, enough. So my problem with curly Q.
I'm dying.
Is whenever I see someone do it, or I guess someone who doesn't do it very well, all I can hear in my head is just.
Oh yeah, like that horrible farting sound that the
like hurling. I don't know.
Yo, Zach's got a dope curly Q now.
What I really like is when it comes out like slowly. That all right. Yeah. I can
Oliver put up a curly QQ vid where he did the curly QQ and then he closed it in the same motion.
Yeah, that was sick. All right, I'm okay with that.
That's disgusting, Oliver. But you keep that shit up, man. You keep that up, man.
Yeah, I'm not as much of a fan of the one where the center of the packet comes out and just looks messy and it's like.
Patch, are you in college right now? Nope, I am a loser. I like trains. I like you. Patch Monkey. Nah, I can't be Patch Monkey. That's taken. Do you follow Curly Q is Bay? I do not follow any of the Bay accounts. I do not.
Are there?
Stallone, man. Come on. All right. I never actually answered this dude's question. He asked me how I made Stallone. Stallone is an example of a move that happened not because I set out to create a purpose. I found a structure. Yeah, this is, like the opposite of Lacoste. This is a move where I was just dicking around. I was actually in the car while I was heading to Pennsylvania. And I was just looking at my reflection. I was just goofing around. And what I found was this moment. I found this structure. This is a crazy structure. I was going to do something like move that there and like slide it.
Yeah.
And very geometric, boxy kind of things. But it ended up being it transitions into a cut. So how do you get from that structure to a cut? I've always loved this. This is a very comfortable mechanic for me. Tobias has this thing right now that he does, which is like genius. He's so smart where he goes like, ooh, oh, this is, when I saw that, I'm like, I've always been right there. And then you just did that because I hate you. it's a great mechanic, very comfortable. So what you do when you're just experimenting with mechanics is you just, everything that you find comfortable, do all of it. Just do all of it. That's all. It's like I was just like, okay, I'm here. I locked into position. This is right in the position. Do a rev. My thumb is already up, so I know I'm gonna try that. So the cost is what happens when you mix together a rev and those motions together, while at the same time you have the structure of this being locked into place, and then the rest is just resolution. So that's how it really came to be. There wasn't really much of a much deliberation. There wasn't like I was sitting down like I want one of these moves, but that I've worked on for a while. That has definitely evolved over time for sure.
So one thing I do want to talk about is the whole resolution thing and trying to get a wrap around the idea that you're trying to expand on. Because I feel like
there's,
at the very least, there, I have a couple pet peeves in that area that I see some of the newer creators fall into. So some of the things like, you know, you'll close, like, I don't know, you'll do some random bullshit, whatnot, and then you'll close a packet, and then you'll pick out a card and try to do some flirty things, and then stuff like that. Trying to drag along the cut for way more than it should.
That's actually been probably the first meme I remember. What was cuts that never know how to close.
Yeah,
and it was like a video where it was like, you went like here, 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 here. You know what I mean? It just kept going, and I'm just like, yeah, that's it. It just feels like they never know how to this thing. Well, like Chase hates that.
Yeah,
like that is such a cop out. Like,
yeah.
Oh yeah, you're not even trying.
Yeah,
you're not even trying. You're a bastard.
I've been almost wondering if you shouldn't close, like, I wonder if, like, it would be an interesting rule to have, like, or more of a guideline to never close, like, a single packet at once. So when you're closing a cut, you should close at least two packets at once with the cut, or something along those lines. You know, obviously exceptions and stuff, but because, like, you know, you'll have a thing where, you know, they'll close one packet and then do something and then close packet one after the other and just drags on and doesn't need to.
Yeah, man. No, like anything that give your mind a lapness. Man. 100%. If sort of like is similar to just having energy that you don't know what to do with. You know, you don't know where the energy is actually supposed to go, so you just end up doing stuff like this. You know what I mean? Like, it's just like close to the bottom. You know, it's like, it's such a cheat. It's such a cheater way out of that. Show something new. Something new.
Wow.
Oh, man. I only rolled up the old sleeve of Rooney's for that.
Boy.
This isn't even a cut.
Ooh.
Yeah.
That tickled me.
Yeah, boy. Yeah, you can't get any more than that. That's all you're getting, bitch.
Are you keeping stuff secret?
Oh yeah, bro.
Yeah, I.
they're all flipping out. They're all flipping out. Good. Yeah. Yeah, no, I am keeping a lot secret. It really sucks, honestly.
I've been having trouble with that recently.
I would love to talk about this. There's a serious problem with the idea that you can't. Creating a move every day isn't hard. I do it all the time. It's not. It really. Some days you make three moves. It's really not. It's not difficult. I guarantee the Great Danes can do it as well. The thing is, it's not cool. It's not cool. It's cool.
Yeah.
This is a rule of nature that anything that is overly abundant is not that attractive. It's just not that cool. If you can have it every single day, multiple times, it's just like, all right, well, okay. Well,
yeah, which is another one.
Yeah, which moves are the special ones? Mm-hmm. You know, that it sucks that as a creator, you have to create this perception of coolness in order for your material to really be effective. It sucks. Yeah. If Noel posted every day, you guys wouldn't think he was as cool.
Yeah.
It sucks. It sucks.
And I mean, there's the thing where, you know, some cardists will just make one video that's just fucking huge because all of their material is new, right?
Yeah, and man.
It's so much more effective than if you make, you know, a couple of videos that are meh, and then you have one that's much better, or not even much better. If they gradually increase, then it's not nearly as effective as you just put that one out there. But that's hard because obviously if you're just making one video, you don't necessarily know how to make videos.
Bro, I would post every day if I could, man. I would put, like, I would be every, but I can't because number one, everyone's telling me I have to save all my material for my new video. You know, every veteran that I know is just like, nah, man, you gotta save that shit. You gotta save that, bro, save that. I'm like, I just like, why? I already have a bunch of crap that like that's just there that I haven't really posted or anything like that. I had an anonymous account at one point where I, you actually, you gave me advice and you didn't even know you did. Yeah, which is funny as hell. Yeah. I do your thing on in my move now. That.
Huh.
Yeah. I put that on Reddit under a different name, and you gave me advice on it.
What did I say?
Yeah, gosh, you son of a bitch. Yeah, I wanted to see how much feedback I could get without being Patrick. And
yeah,
I had another account, and I put shit on Reddit. I tagged people in my videos. I wanted to see what would happen, and I did get some very valuable advice, actually. What you told me to do in that move was to spin the card as it came out instead of waiting and then spinning it. I wouldn't have done that. So thanks, Matt.
Got you.
Thanks, Matt. What was your inspiration behind Hippity Hoppity? The song. Mm-hmm. Every great video, every video that I've kept up is there because I found a song that led to that was the offset for a video.
Yeah.
Hippity Hoppity, I heard that shit and I was just like, yo, this is it. Yeah, I'm like, that's totally my vibe. I'm totally gonna do that. Mm-hmm. But it was also the premise of I have filmed in every room of my house, including the bathrooms, all of them. You guys don't know the difference, you know, anything. Except my closet. I have an attic in my closet. And I realized, like, that is such a dope premise for a video. Like, yep. Patrick is in his room, and then he discovers a room in his room. That's the coolest idea for a video. I'm so sad that that video isn't as cool as it should have been. Truthfully, what happened with that video was it was so freaking hot
in the attic, yeah.
And my hands were sweating so bad I couldn't do most of the material that I wanted to do. And yeah. I ended up having to make do with what I could. I walked out of that attic with like 26 fontanes because I dropped them and they fell through the floor. It was so annoying. So annoying. Could you show us Gargantua? Gargantua, I'm not going to be able to do this. Gargantua is the one that's my my David Peterson thing. It's like that. This is only one card. I messed up, guys. I'm sorry. Don't hate me. No! No! Yeah, no, it's actually really hard to do this cut. I just thought this moment is so fun to do, that little structure. Mm. But it's literally just I wanted to make a move like Frankie's stuff. You know, Frankie has a lot of cuts that just go on and on and on and on. And, like, I love that style. But come back to here, and it's always connected by, like, these shapes. And I didn't really have, like, a Rolling Stones style cut, you know. But it's hard, man. It's hard to hit that cut. Mm-hmm. It's tough. There's a lot of moments where you can fuck it up.
Yeah.
Man, Paz Mechzi messed up. I'm sorry, guys. What inspires you? You guys. I steal all your stuff. That's it. That's all I do. I just look at your accounts and I take your stuff. Daniel Lin has perfected that philosophy of not releasing moves. I think he knew that he was getting ready for the next championship. And he had that angle going into it, which was just like no one knew anything about what he was gonna do. I think Noel has that, Matt. I think Noel is the one that really has that philosophy down. Like, he's the one that is the most just discreet and selective about what he shows, and he's just he has branded himself beautifully. You know, just incredibly well done.
His last video was absolutely stellar.
Tell about right, bro. Did you steal from Rose? Nah, dog. I didn't steal from Rose. Whatever happened to Avanth? Frankie just had other things going on. You know, I think he took up another job. And then, Avanth has just been on the back burner for a little while. But Avanth isn't like done. It's just that he hasn't been. He's been working on something else for a little while now. Blah 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 blah. Quality over quantity, hell yeah. Quality over quantity is that is what people want. But here's the thing though, is that at a certain point, if I can show you a lot of quantity, people start to think I'm a little smarter. Sure. is that it's true because Darren has a lot of great moves, but a lot of the appeal of Darren is that he can do them really well.
Yeah.
He's a machine. He's a mechanical, just wow, that guy. If you just take his repertoire, he's got six or seven, probably, right? Like six or seven is a fair number of like perfect done moves that I say are accredited to Darren. I'd say Tobias has him beat, honestly. I'd say Tobias has Darren beat in terms of because he's got quantity. He's got him on quantity. He does. And the problem is that if Squeeze really took years to make, Darren cannot touch Tobias. I told this to Chase. This is a funny idea. Can you if Tobias did Anaconda, most people would think he was better than Darren. I really think that all Tobias has to do is just do Anaconda.
Yeah.
That's it. It's like just do a vert. A vert move, like a vert skater move. Just do a vert move, and that's it. Can't touch you. Can't touch you. You know. Oh, I would love to talk about the difference between a cardist and a card flourisher.
Oh, interesting.
I really love this idea.
All right, let's go nuts.
Because the problem with being a great card flourisher is that all you have to do is demonstrate your proficiency and show that you are excellent at doing card flourishes. Mm-hmm. And now people look at you and they go, you're the best cardist in the world. And I'm like, no, they are the best card flourisher. They're the best at doing card flourishes. A cardist is the other package, is the guy who is part of the community actively, is part of the community. He still makes performance videos. He is evolving with the scene. He has a personal style that changes and grows. You know what I mean? Like if you've been the same guy for years, you've just gotten better at what you do. Mm. It's like, yeah, man, you're not being a cardist. You know what I mean? If you're not looking for videos and liking videos and commenting, letting kids know when they're good. And like looking for inspiration and really trying to think of the next thing. You're not a cardist. You're a card flourisher. Hmm. You know what I mean? Card flourisher.
Yeah.
You know how much do you think Darren actually does that? You know, I don't think that much.
Hmm.
You know, I think that Darren is more. I think for me, it's a debate between Andre Jit and Darren for like best card flourisher, just most proficient card flourisher.
Yeah.
From a mechanical standpoint, they're incredible. But from a cardist standpoint, are they the most compelling cardists in the world? No. No, they're not.
Yeah.
You know, that's why I've always looked at Tobias as being the first real skater for me. Like the first guy that really knocked down that style. And you know, combos are really making a serious. Like you see that they post their combos mainly now.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are confused by that, you know, and you understand that they understand that it's strategic to consistently demonstrate your proficiency while you work on your material.
Yeah. No, it makes sense.
You don't have to be quiet. You can keep proving that you're amazing. but you get to work on all your other stuff. It makes sense.
Yeah.
I get it. I don't, you know, I suck at it, you know? let me see.
Yeah, it's. I think I've been making the transition between card flourisher and cardists in the past year, basically, and now doing the streams and stuff. Hopefully, that goes in that direction.
Dude, I wish the streams and podcasts. I want just as Kevin put it, a discourse. I want the conversation to be ongoing. But at the same time, a podcast is so much better because a podcast, you can just kind of listen to it in the background.
Yeah, no, I think it's
so, I love that. I think that's a much more efficient, you know, or effective rather format.
Yeah.
Or flexible.
Yeah, that's it.
I wouldn't risk squids in the shower because trainers are acrylic and I know they are okay in the shower. Matt, quit being a bitch and get in the shower with your squid because it'll change your life. It'll change your goddamn life. Just get in a bathtub.
Just go.
Yo, Patrick, you should make a Carter Street magazine for BCA. That may or may not be a thing in the workings. I don't know.
Ooh.
I don't work there. I don't run. I don't know any of that stuff. Why portals over squid? Oh yeah, they're talking about the shower. Griff wants to know what I meant by a vert skater. If a vert skater is someone that skates a half pipe. Yeah, so it's like you know, Tony Hawk is a vert skater. You know, what I mean, someone that does like the X Games style skating. You know, Rodney Mullen is a freestyler. He does like, you know, he does tricks that are you know, he's based on flat ground tricks. You know, and I'm pretty sure that's freestyle. And then street is the idea of skating through terrain. And like grinding and going downstairs and all that. So the verts, I think it's funny that they're called the verts because that is more or less what they represent to the community. They are the verts, they're vert skaters. They are Tony Hawk. Please, more about difference cardist and card flourisher. It is interesting. I really do like this question, cardist versus card flourisher.
It's interesting because I've never heard about that distinction before.
It's something that came up in my head only because, well, I mean, best cardist alive.
Yeah. You know, no, yeah.
Best card. What does that mean, cardist? You know. And also, the funny part is that I actually consider cardistry photography to be cardistry. I think that's. Mm-hmm. Part of the picture, you know what I mean? And like, yeah, if like somebody that
cardistry videos,
like somebody that specializes in cardistry pictures, that's a cardist. That's a form of cardist.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? And I evaluate them as a cardist. Is a card artist,
right?
You know?
Yeah,
not necessarily sense. I can just do the springs and the fans and anaconda, and I can just do my material perfectly every single time. You're a phenomenal card flourisher. There are phenomenal card flourishers that are not great cardists.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, you know, and it's
Brian Tudor.
Brian Tudor is a Brian Tudor is a very I would love to talk to Brian Tudor.
Oh, I would not.
Get him on the show. Are you shitting me? Get him. Oh, I would love to talk to him for like this. They would get old after like 30 minutes, but I would love to talk to him.
I feel like it would get old after a solid 2 minutes.
Nah, man. You know how frustrating it must be to be right before everybody else is right? And then when somebody else is right in the same way you were right, everyone says they're amazing. I'd be bitter too. I'd be so bitter if I was Brian too. Are you fucking kidding me? Yeah, I'd be bitter. I'd be so bitter, man. But like, I always look at him as being that. He was the first packet cutter. as the first packet cutter, the first guy that understood the game of packet cutting. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? He's created, I think he created the game. Chris Kenner is the one that, like, if you look at the genealogy of Sybil, if you look into that, you know, obviously.
I mean, yeah, you could also go to back to Kalush or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
But
yeah.
But the thing is that
the game of just creating several arrangements of packet cuts, mm-hmm. I feel is very much Brian Suter's. Then Dan and Dave, I think, are the ones that really refine that into what you know it is today. They created a system. Literally, they created that system. They called it a system, which is just like beautiful, great. And then I don't think that packet cutting became what it is today until the Danes got their hands on it. Mm-hmm. I think they
definitely changed the game.
I think Darren and Tobias perfected it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Darren and Tobias and Dominique Mastriani.
Mm-hmm. Well,
yeah, I think they were the ones that perfected it for sure. What's your advice to establish yourself on Instagram as a cardist? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. It's easy. Let me tell you that. It's easy. You can do two things. You can do one of two things. You have to either be better or different. Okay? You have to either be better or different. Different, like Cardistroy.
Yeah.
Cardistroy is different. And that made Shivraj huge.
Yeah.
Made him fucking huge. He didn't have to beat all the cardists to get that following. He just had to be different. Be different. Or be better. Aim to be better than Tobias. That's, you know, whichever one you think is more attainable. That's all you have to do. Do that and have a style. Have a personal style. Pick people in the community that you really love and respect and you want to look like. And picture in your head, what would it look like if I mixed those guys together? You know, what would it be if I put those styles together? What would that look like? And then that's you. That's what that means. That's all it is. Yeah. I am Aviv plus D4I plus Darren plus Frankie.
Sure. Yeah.
There you go. There you go. Yo, is Pat drunk or is he always so high? I'm always hype, dude. Only about cardistry in my height.
Yeah.
I emailed Kevin and he said they're still working. Who's the best cardist? y'all are going to make it to 5 hours. We are not going to make it to 5 hours. No way. Thoughts on Henrik? I love Henrik. Henrik
is fantastic, yeah.
Henrik, dude, Henrik's video on Nero. Nero was like the first time I ever saw like a kid, felt like another kid cardist who like made the shit out of his video. Like really made his video and like really edited it and put it together and it felt like a whole package. You know, it was the first time I ever saw that. Really respect Henrik. And his packet coding, his material is still hugely relevent today.
Yeah, you know, it's
a
really
lot
good.
Of stuff. Yeah. Yeah, like the his move a window. Yeah, man. Oh, dude, this thing that he does, like the what is it? This thing or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that was incredible.
Yeah.
That move at the time was like, you got to be kidding me, man. Like that was amazing. That and Nintendo were just next level cuts. Honestly, I think it would be funny as far to talk to you in person. I am pretty funny, yo. thoughts on Elliot Slevin. Elliot's a great example of just finding a way to distinguish yourself. Find a style, distinguish yourself. He filmed from a very specific angle for that. Oh, he had that. I remember I knew about Elliot before I even knew his name because he had a different name at the time. He was like freezing aces or something like that. Actually, people used to compare me to him at one point. Because
oh, really?
My whole, yeah. Back in the day when I first got started out, people said I looked like a combination of Elliot Slevin and Thomas Maten.
Hmm.
And that's funny. And if you don't know, Thomas Maten is another one. another one, he's from the generation before me, you know, and so he's got a lot of experience, and a lot of people underestimate him, I think. But he's just got, oh, dude, he's like, he just needs to be more confident in his material, man. You know, what is your advice for the new persons who like cardistry? What do you mean by that? Can you word that differently? Do you guys use 52 cards or use all the cards in the pack? I actually don't use a full deck. I rarely ever use a full deck. I use something closer to like 46 cards, around that, 40, 45, 46 cards. It just feels nicer.
Yeah.
I hate this idea that that's somehow less impressive. It's just like, who cares, man? Like, yeah, are you still in? You're still in that world. Reprogram. Reprogram, dog.
Yeah, no, I actually just don't really care about the number of cards. I just open a, you know, I'll lose some and they'll be less, and I'm like, oh, that's, yeah, it's better. Whatever.
Dude, I couldn't care less about it. Most of my cards, I lose cards too much to care about having a full deck.
Yeah.
You know? Reprogram. I take out five thoughts on Oliver. So good. Oliver, yeah, man. Oliver is like, man, Oliver really, the quote from Oliver talking about how simplicity is another form of, is a question of complexity. I think that's what he said. Beautifully said. I love his style. I really don't think that Tobias could be what he is now without Oliver. I don't think he ever would have made Flip Phone without Oliver. I don't think he ever would have made Acrid without Oliver.
Yeah.
Just Oliver's influence. And so, and vice versa. Power partnership. Like, it's incredible. And Nikolai is just. There are days where I think Nikolai is the best of the three. Honestly, the only thing is that Nikolai just doesn't flex as much. He doesn't show off his combos as much as the other two do. But Nikolai is a genius. He's a genius. I really think they're all three of them are brilliant. They're all just brilliant, brilliant human beings, and I it's amazing that we've even come into contact with them. Like, just because of
it. Yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah.
I never would have heard of them. Thoughts on Kevlar's memes? We're gonna talk about Kevin Carlson. We're gonna talk about that boy. Let's talk about that boy.
First of all, he's really tall.
Is he tall? Is he?
Yeah,
I like that.
Really tall.
I like that. I like that Kevin Carlson is a person that can look down at you. Yeah. No, I love that. That's great. I hated him. I hated his memes. I hated everything about his personal style. And then, you know, it got to a point where I was like, why are you being a bitch, man? Why are you being a bitch about this, dog? It's not that big of a deal. And then I realized that I'm like, wait, this guy actually does have funny memes. Like, there are several that I've been like, I actually like this one. And like, dude, the cardistry jokes page, and like 98% of that is so cringe. So cringy. Like, that, like, look, I'm not a huge fan. I'm like, every now and then Kevin gets it right. I'm just saying, like, that is true. And he put my face on a shirt, and like, oh, dude, I jumped down his throat on that, bro. I went off on this kid over that. I felt so bad after. I'm like, I think I even tagged Tobias, though. I was like, can you put a leash on this thing? I was like, you, God damn it! Like, why is this? And I read it so wrong.
You know? Yeah.
I read it like as such a fuck you. I read it as such a giant, like, but like in reality, well, it's funny. Max, I was talking to Max about this, and he was just like, whoa, kid in Europe put your face on a shirt and you're upset.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, dude, oh, no, I'm wrong. Oh, I'm wrong, man. I'm totally wrong. Oh, my God damn it. I'm wrong. And then you realize, like, that's dope. My face is on some kid's shirt in Europe. That's crazy.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Like, yeah, that's awesome. But, like, I didn't read it that way at all, man. Ah. But then I realized I was being a bitch. But I'm sorry, Kevin. I'm sorry about that. If you ever watched this, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I imagine that it's way late for him.
Yeah, it's probably super late over there.
3 a.m., in fact.
Yeah, man. The hang on, let me see. Hang on, Nikolai diss 23. What diss? What diss? How did I diss Nikolai? What are you talking about? Guess was the gen. Oh my god, you remember that. Patrick, what do you think about Dennis Jin? Dude, Dennis Jin could have been he could have totally been in that same. Like, he is in the same category as Tobias Oliver, Nikolai. Like as far as Dynamite Squad will always be the coolest boy band. That is still the coolest boy band, and Dennis is the shit. I love Dennis. I wish he showed more. Dennis is amazing. It's 2 a.m. for me. It's still going.
That's the spirit.
Yeah. Yeah. Mantra's being released. Oh, word. Mantra's a great cut, bro.
Yeah, what a cut.
Did they announce that? Let me check their Instagram. I want to see.
They said something new was coming. I don't know if that's...
I thought that was just the video. The video for Oliver. Oh, wait, no. Oh, yeah, new release on set. Yeah, it's totally Mantra. Look at him.
Yeah.
Wait, no. Wait, is it? Yeah, that's Mantra. That's totally Mantra. Look at it. That is totally Mantra.
Yep.
That's a great cut. I got to say, that's probably the best one-handed thing he's made for me, honestly. Mm-hmm. Because it has the waves cut in it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It has the waves cut in it, but it's like, you're a genius, man. That's such a complete package, that cut.
Yeah.
That move, rather. What do you guys think about Quan? What do we think about Quan?
Quan.
He's great.
Yeah, he's fantastic.
Great, he's great. He's got that shit.
he's got
that good stuff.
Gets it.
Definitely. He gets it. he gets it. What's your favorite deck to use?
Favorite deck to use? I am personally a big fan of the EPCC series, Expert Playing Cards.
That's funny, actually. Yeah, there was a point when EPCC, LPCC was like my favorite. I had Legends Playing Cards. Mm-hmm. Legends were just like the coolest, just because it was like a deck for packet cutters.
Yeah, basically. Yeah,
that's how I felt about it. It was like they kind of all worked like Aladdin's.
Yeah.
You know,
yes.
Like, Aladdin's get to that point where they're, oh man, when I first got my first deck of Aladdin's, mm-hmm. I felt like I unlocked the secret of the Great Danes. I was like, I get it now. Of course, that's what you guys make. Of course, you use Aladdin's. Yeah, man. Of course, you guys make all that stuff.
Be fair, my assessment of the EPCC cards may be a bit tainted, given that I have like a shit ton of them from ICO. So, you know.
Oh my god, I should have done ICO. I should have done that. I can't say anything. I can't say anything about winning a championship. No, that's not true. I think it's so funny that my character, like my persona in the community, is like this, like gallivanting, like I'm the best, like, you know, ostentatious, like, yeah, I'm the what? This is a game. I'm the best. It's like whenever there's a championship or anything, I just be like, y'all gonna lose. I'm the best. You know, you guys just shouldn't enter. Just don't enter. Just don't. Just that's so funny.
Don't even bother. It's
like, honestly, I'm like trying to scare kids away. Oh, it is. I just want to, like, for the kids that actually buy into that. Which one do you think appeals more to layman visually? The cards versus Baosong versus Begley versus Pens versus Kendama? I think that you could sell them all as the same thing, honestly. I think that cardistry's got a lot of I think cardistry's got the most flexibility probably out of all that, but that's like I don't really know anything.
I think the problem, quote unquote, problem with Balisong, actually more like Baglerian pent spinning, is that it all kind of looks the same. And it's one of those things where the mechanics are more interesting than the visuals, I think.
Whereas
cardistry, you have like such a huge range.
It's very esoteric as well. It's super hard to just kind of, you know, to get the appeal of all of it. I unblock Kevin? Yeah, I unblock Kevin. I follow them. I love his photos. I put him on Best Cardist Alive. Kids were like, oh shit. What is happening? I'm like, it's all right, man.
It's fine. Don't worry about it.
You took a nice picture of a thumb fan, man. Relax. Kendama doesn't appeal to layman as much as cardistry. That's true, but Kendama is way more fun than cardistry. Kendama has a much more fun community, much healthier community. But I think they know that it's all about the toy. They just really love the toy. You know, that's great. That's really great for them because, you know, there's so many things about Kendama that make it a great toy that we don't have. Like the fact that we have the ability to like if we drop cards, it's over.
Yeah, it's over. Just
their ball is on a string, man.
Yeah, that's cheating.
They're good. Their ball is on a string. Cardistry Disc 2016. Shut up, man. I posted my first my CCC audition video. I was like, I am not going home in round one, and then I went home in round one. Like, that is the most depressing shit ever.
Yeah. My plan was to get to round one and then get dropped in round one, but whoops, that didn't happen.
Yeah, and I've always had problems with how the championships are run. But I just don't like the format. I don't like the four round format. I don't like tournaments. I think that's boring. And I think you should be able to just go as hard as you can, and whoever is the best cardist is the one that wins.
Yeah.
Just have a deadline. You know, there you have a deadline. This is when your video's due. Boom, there, 60 seconds. That's it. That's all you have. I might do that on Best Cards Live. I'm going to do that.
Yeah, there we go. I'm going to do that shit.
Dominique and his never released video. Yeah, man, for real, though. Like, Dominique Marciani makes me so sad, man. Oh, God. Just because, like, I want to see his stuff so badly. You know?
Yeah.
Dude, but he has some of the best material, man. Yeah, man. Rip me. Rip me. Rip me. I'll get you guys on the next championship. Whatever. Well, actually, it's lame though, because now I'm doing Best Cardist Alive stuff. You know what I mean? It's just like, I feel kind of weird participating in this stuff now. I feel like I'm the guy that has to run that stuff now.
Yeah.
It's just like, God damn it. This is why I didn't want to be the guy that ran the page. Will you release another edition for soundboards? I don't know. Oh. Maybe. I don't know. I don't know if I did a Kickstarter for those. I don't think they'd do all that well. But I don't know anything. That's my
theory. Things are so hard to anticipate.
It's such a shot in the dark, man.
Yeah.
Ooh, like, for all I know, everybody wants them, and it's just like, oh. What are your thoughts on utility moves? I love utility moves. I have a few, actually. I've got this thing. I love that. It's called a merge, because you merge two packets together, and it's a super automatic motion. It's really automatic. Like, you just hear, and then you just curl your middle finger,
the whole thing
happens by itself. There's that. I love two packet things like this, like that. That's here. You push that around. It spins. You pull that one around. Eh? Like that. Little stuff. That's all fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
Fun. You know, little things you just throw in here and there. The thoughts on welcome the cardistry touch vid. Ooh. Man, cardistry touch is just the They like cardistry touch is just, they've got my vote for the cardistry company. I want like they're yeah, the only yeah, yeah. cardistry company that I think I'm gonna officially endorse with Best Cardist Alive, and just advertise them and just very openly support them. I would love to do business with them.
Yeah.
I think they do everything right, exactly how I would want it done.
Yeah, and yeah, yeah, yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful what they're doing. I love the work they're doing.
Yeah, I am.
What is a utility move? A utility. I cut you off. Go.
No,
I'm not letting you chime in, man. I'm sorry.
I was just going to point out that I am going to do a stream with the fine people at Cardists to Touch at some point in the future. I'm not.
We're like Dimitri and Ladislas.
Yep.
That's gonna be cool. Both of them.
Actually, I have a couple streams lined up, so there will be more of this.
Nice. Nice. You didn't win because then you dominate in the next round. Bro, I got my they wanted me out of that champ. They knew I'd win. They knew I'd win. They let me through. Nah, man. It's whatever. I wasn't going to come out and say anything bitter about that because then there's nothing that even if it's a valid criticism.
Yeah, no, it just doesn't work.
I was just going to come across as a sore loser. You know?
Yeah.
So it's like, all right, just keep quiet. In fact, the video I put up the next day, the caption was the shrugging emoji or whatever. It was like the shrug. It's like that was the extent of the what I had to say about it. Do that hand transfer that you showed Leo and me. Hand transfer? What's a hand transfer?
You take your hand and put it in the other hand, you know.
You would be the Kanye of cardistry. I am the Kanye of cardistry. That is my goal, to be the Kanye of cardistry. I'm like, what's funny is that I did actually plan at some point to stop saying I'm the best cardist alive and to just start saying I'm God. Like I'm just like just start commenting on totally unrelated videos. I'm God. I'm God. Like, and everyone's just replying like, thanks. You know what I mean? Like I'm saying, like, thanks. I'm God. Yeah. Oh, that's cool. I'm God. Mm-hmm. Ha. How about change my name to just God? I'm just God. I don't mean to blaspheme. I'm just God. Oh man. Who's the Kim Kardashian of cardistry? No comment. No freaking comment.
Yeah.
How many black cardists do you know of? Three. I know three. I don't know three, but I know of three.
Yeah. Diversity is not the greatest strong point of the cardistry community.
Yeah. Is it good to think of aspects of a flourish as a technique or a concept? In my opinion, creativity is a strategy. It's a strategy. It's not a state of being. It's not conceptual. It's very much a strategic way of thinking. So the aspects of a flourish, I look at it as technique. I think it's very technique based. And you could get conceptual about why you utilize those aspects, but the aspects themselves, I think, are very just technical, you know. Patrickism. You guys better pray to me. I swear to God, yo. You start throwing up the sign, dude. Best cardist alive, dog. Best card. I have a gang sign, man. Hold that up for a bit so everybody can lock it down. I just want everybody to. Okay, let me just give you a quick tutorial for all the viewers at home. Point your fingers to each other. Middle fingers to your thumbs. All right, that's how you do it. That's the Best Cardist Alive logo. It's amazing. Rep me around the world. Don't get kicked out of school.
Did you sit down in your room and with your hands are like, all right, cool. So can I go like this? Oh no, that's too many spikes.
Nope. And literally what happened was I was talking to Chase. And you know how Zach every now and then he does like that?
Yeah.
Like that. I was doing that at Chase. I was getting off the phone, and I was being like, all right, yo, peace, man. Peace late, man. And then I threw up the other hand, and I was just goofing around. I'm like, dog, diggity dog. And I was just like, wait, that's my logo. Wait a minute. Hey, Chase, that's my logo, Chase. Check it out, man. I did it. There was no moment of like sitting down and trying. It literally.
I wouldn't imagine.
I just ran into it one day. Remember, Billy, I looked into this. I don't think it's a real gang sign. I'm pretty sure that's a gang sign. I'm pretty sure it's a gang sign. Don't get shot. don't do this. Patrick, do goddessry. Goddessry. I'm not saying that. I am a god. I'll be up with my damn massage. Yeah, man. That's so funny. That's totally taken. That is definitely just that. That is a gang sign. Do not use that. This is not. That's not. And if it is, you didn't hear it from me. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't even do cardistry.
Oh, I have a question for you. Do you do any form of stretching for your arms on a regular basis or not?
No, I don't, yo.
No, is it
fat ass? I'm like, I'm an unhealthy, just horrible cardist with terrible habits. Patch.god. They just said change it to patch.god.
Ooh, that's catchy.
Oh, guys, I might do that. Oh, I'm looking at my phone. I'm eyeing my phone right now, yo. Patch.god. I don't know. Is that like, will I get in trouble for that? I will be the god of the new world, Pat 2016. Oh, all right. I got to do that. Yeah, right now. I'm gonna take my phone right now. You just look at me. Look at me as I do it. Patch is better not be taken. I swear to God, if it's taken, I'm gonna be really upset. Patch.god. Hang on, wait. Can I write up like a pros and cons list first? Is that, am I allowed? Patch.god. All right, it's up. I did it, boys. I did it, boys. I did it. I did it for you guys. I did it for the love. Oh my god. All right, yo, one of you just liked every single goddamn post I've ever posted in my life. You guys are heavy. I appreciate the love. I did it. No, Patch God is not taken already. Patch.god is fine. Patch.god is not taken. I just did.
Well, it is now.
Yeah, it's taken now. Oh, we made history today. We did. I'm a god now. Let the record stand on the 30th of July 2016. Patch Bar became a god. Nah, change your profile picture to Jesus doing an ISO? Nah. Nah, man, I can't do that. Do you have notifications on for Instagram? No, I do not, because I like people don't leave me alone. Like I can't have that on.
I do not have notifications either, and that is a very conscious decision.
Patch.god. Reprogramism is the new religion. Reprogram. My faith is reprogrammed. Preach the good word. Someone take Patch Var before you can take it back. Fuck you, man. Somebody will take Patch.var. Take it. You take it. Whatever. I'll change. Yeah, I don't care. I don't need you guys.
Patrick.
Now I need to change the description to my posts.
I took Patch Bar. I'm sorry, God. Whatever, man. I don't need you guys. Patch.God. Shiv doing multiple ISOs. Just Shiv throwing it up like this.
Yeah.
Just that. That's my.
You see the CCC Run 5 video?
Yeah, I did. That's so funny. I love this thing when I push it through.
And yeah.
It's so good.
Oh, that was fun. That was an experience.
I'm God now. I'm a God. I'm a rap God. Rap God. In the back. Nah. I've been posting too much on Best Cardist Lab. Gotta take it easy. Feeling Godistry. Our card report patch.god. Yeah. Rep it. Patch.god. Reprogram, dog. I'm gonna start a gang. Like, someone's gonna get punched. Like, I better not hear that at Cardistry Con somebody start a fight with somebody else over the one true Lord and Savior. Like, you better, like, relax.
The fucking Fontaine kids on one side of the room.
Oh, man. Pass that guy, vote me. Pass that guy, Cardistry President 2020. 2020. You think I was gonna turn back to Patch Var? You think I'm a bitch?
Man, you know who I am?
I'm God, dog. Dude, I can't wait for all the memes of Kevin Carlson, like with a halo around my head.
It's happening.
Like, just this, like red. You know what I mean? That's my this. Like, oh, dude. That's,
I'm looking forward to the future.
This is what you expected this to be. This stream was gonna turn into feeling Godistry. We think you're God now. You better think I'm God. What do you think about? All right, a real question.
All right,
bring it back down, boys.
Well then.
Bring it back down, boys. what do you think about the Cardistry books? I love Cardistry books. I think printed media is the future. Yep. I think they've cracked the code, which is the idea that all this intellectual property sold in the form of downloads simply it's not really all that practical. And the fact that people can just share it around is really frustrating. So there has to be a way to get people to commit to your intellectual property. And this is how you do that. You sell them a physical book. That's great. I love it. I approve of it. I haven't read any of them because I know all their material. What do you think? I think I need them. Nah, I need them. I need their material.
I need their material. The Dimitri's book is really good. Partially just because it needs to exist.
How did you get high with none of us seeing? Man. I'm a God, bro. I'm God. I'm just high off life, man. What did you think the game was here? Hey, yeah, no, Dimitri's book. Talk on.
Yeah, no, Dimitri's book is good not only because it has great content and stuff, but also just that it exists, that there's a book about creation, and I think that's a really important step. It will get sold through other vendors at some point in the future. So people who aren't at Cardistry Con will have the opportunity to get them.
Do you think that DVDs are dead? Do you think that's a dead format?
As in physical DVDs? Yeah. I mean, computers don't even have DVD players anymore.
Right. At this point, it's like...
Yeah.
And the thing is, once they get the disc, they just like rip the disc, send all the files around. It's like, goddamn, it's a little bit harder to take pictures of every page of your book. You can do it, but it's process, you know? Man, it's like, if you're willing to go that far, it's like, Jesus, man.
I'm sure people have.
You do Cockistry, Pat. Do Godistry, yo. Yeah, man, I feel you.
I mean, hey, you know, you can do Riffle Fan on anything.
What about the My Shuffles app? I feel it. I really like that.
I'm really excited for it because it's something I definitely need. My current system just doesn't work for what I need.
Honestly, it's never gotten to a point where I felt like I had material that I really needed to organize. You know what I mean? Like I need 10 moves that I'm working on actively.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I have an idea, typically it's like, oh, okay, I'm there. It's done.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That was it. It's funny. Like I'm looking at the time right now. Like, I'm like, am I going for 5 hours? Like, am I doing a charity like fundraiser? Let's make it 5 hours. Like for a cause, for reprogram.
I can tell you that the current accumulation of all of the views is 111 hours. We've wasted 111 man hours.
really?
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
Okay, Griff asks, what is your current system, Matt?
Yes. My current system is real shitty. I will take a video. I'll work on something. If I'm in the mood, I'll shoot a video on my phone and then just have it there. If it's something that I definitely want to work on / I want to tag, I'll make it a favorite so I could just find it. And every like month or so, I'll be like, oh, hey, I should look back at all my previous stuff and just scroll through. Like, oh, hey, this was cool. I should look into it again. Or
And how long do you typically work on? Like, are you one that like you like to put in the time? Like, how long on average does it take you?
For what specifically?
Like a 4-packet cut.
It really depends. Like some cuts just like it's like Dropbox. Sometimes it just works and it just happens. Like this one, which is pretty popular. Oops, if I can do it.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. This. I love this.
Yeah. Wait, let me.
I put no, dude. I think that was the first. I feel like that's the first thing from you that I put on Best Cards Alive.
Yeah. I think only thing maybe. Oh no, no. There was the.
There was
the go-around thing.
Oh yeah, the three, the triple earnings, right?
Yeah. But yeah, this is one of them where like I had this idea and then the rest just basically followed. Just because like if you think about like the range of motion you have, like it does just make sense. So and you know, there are a couple of decisions to be made, but yeah, and on the other hand, there's the not Trump cut. which
not
Trump cut. Yeah,
not
this
Trump word. Not Trump. Not Trump, not Trump.
Not Trump.
Not Trump. Forward.
Actually, I should just fuck with everyone, call it Hillary. the not Trump cut is interesting because, first of all, I've been working on it in a long time, just, you know, incrementally. But also, it was difficult enough that I had to practice it without knowing if it was going to actually look good for like a really long time.
Yeah, man, you gotta have faith.
Yeah,
got lots of faith in that, man. It's really funny.
Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
Stallone was the same way. I was just like, this might look good in some contexts from the right angle if you squint.
Yeah,
a bit. I might be able to sell this as a move.
Yeah,
I really like this question. Let's see, Adam Sharp, real question. What's your thought of how mainstream cardistry is getting? Are you afraid that it will become as mainstream as magic and won't be as special in the future? Not so much. Honestly, I think that I am probably at the forefront of that, you know, trying to figure out how do you make cardistry into something that is mainstream. And I mean, actually mainstream, not yeah. Like, because the verts they create viral videos. And those viral videos take over the internet, and that's like really, really odd. But I want to create a lasting mainstream infrastructure that people just, oh yeah, you can just, there's cardistry. It's just there. Do I think that's a bad thing? Do I think that takes coolness away from us? I think we have to be open-minded. You know, I think we have to be open to change, and we have to be open to growing. Honestly, that's what I was trying to communicate with the whole reprogram thing. You know, what I was just trying to communicate is that we're at a point now where we're growing faster than we've ever been. And people are branching off more so than ever because we're starting to realize that we can just try more and more things.
and we can really distinguish ourselves and stand out in the world and create something different, you know? And yeah. that I think we have to be open to the idea of them seeing us in a certain way and us being okay with that. You know, because it's just like, yeah, we don't really know what cardistry looks like yet. That's why Best Cardist Alive is so exciting, is because, you know, for the first time, we're really getting to see what it means to be, like, how big cardistry can really be. You know what I mean? Like, 52 cards has got over 48,000 followers or something like that. Yeah, 48,000 followers. That is not a cardistry specific page, and it's not being ran by people of note within the community. So here we have a dedicated cardistry infrastructure that is backed by the reputations of notable cardists in the community. For me, infrastructure that's backed by reputation will always be the thing that takes over. Fontaine. Yep. Fontaine is the best example of this. Fontaine, the Blue Fontaine campaign proved to everyone that if you can bring all the cardists in the world together for one thing, you can make something crazy happen.
Yeah.
You can make something insane happen. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm going to do that, but with every cardist.
Yeah.
All the time. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I think it can be done. I think that we can make it mainstream in a way that's healthy and doesn't weigh in on this. I'm really curious to hear what you have to say about this.
Well, first of all, there's kind of two types of mainstream. There is mainstream as in there's more cardists that do more people that do cardistry. That's one thing. There's also mainstream terms like people know about cardistry and don't do it and might be interested in like seeing cuts but don't ever touch a deck of cards, and they're very different. And you know, when the verts are trying to appeal also to laymen, and that's a very different, it's really different than making a cardistry video for laymen versus for cardists is like making a magic trick for layman versus cardist. It's just completely different beast. So one of the things that like I personally really don't like explaining what cardistry is to laymen the first time.
I hate it. It's such a boring conversation.
Because the thing is that like it doesn't sound as cool as it is. Like it's like, oh yeah, I'm just, you know,
you're a bad magician. is what you've communicated to me. Like,
yeah, you're a magician like, that doesn't care about like
a gender confused magician. like you don't know like what you're doing. It's just, it's such an annoying conversation to have.
Because the thing is that,
Go on.
Yeah, it's hard because like, it's hard for cardistry not to sound like, oh no, look at all this cool shit I can do. You know, in the XCMY style, where it's like, oh, I can do these crazy shit, and oh man, look. Whereas cardistry is a lot more of an artistic thing, it's hard for people to grasp that at first. And I've always had a lot more success explaining cardistry by saying, oh yeah, you know, I do manipulation of cards. Here's a video. Look at this video. And just by virtue of having in a video with, you know, the music and the editing and all of that frames it a lot more into an artistic frame.
That's kind of lame. It's a little lame. Like and it's actually the I had two lectures in mind that I was debating for a convention. The other one, outside of the creative process one where I just broke down Dropbox, mm-hmm. was this idea of cardistry 2. Is we have, as a culture, we have shifted in the sense that in the beginning we were based off of magic and juggling, but now I think we're based off of skateboarding and pen spinning. Mm-hmm. It is different now, and I think here's the best example of this is the fact that we still use the word flourish.
Mm-hmm.
What an awful word.
Yeah.
What an awful, lame, uncool word. But you know where that comes from, right? Juggling. Jugglers. Jugglers use the word flourish. And magicians took it from jugglers, and we took it from magicians. And honestly, the word trick makes more sense. The problem is that card trick already means something.
Yeah, damn it.
Yeah, right? That's the reason why I say squids are great is because they break out of all those associations. You know, I was helping out Chase with his lecture this year. And, you know, I dropped reprograms in there. I wish I could have seen that live. You know, it's such a shame. But I said that there are certain associations that are built in to playing cards. And there's nothing we can do about them.
Yeah.
We can't do anything about them. We can hope that one day cardists will become one of those associations. But understand that it will always be. Well, I don't want to say always. I hate that word always. Yeah. It's very unlikely that cardistry will rise above the three associations that are before it, being 52 pickup, which, believe it or not, like that. Yeah. Right. Right. So annoying. 52 pickup, gambling, and magic. You know what I mean? That's the list they run down in their head. Oh, you're a magician? No, okay. No, you're a card shark. Okay. Well, I'd drop those cards I would just drop those. And then you get cardists.
Yeah.
And then they entertain the idea of, oh, he's like a skateboarder kind of. But like a pens. Oh, all right. Okay. I can kind of get down with that. Then they entertain that idea. With this, it's just like you have a toy. Yeah, but sorry, what are those? Oh, I got them. Big epiphany that we had was the idea that this is just called packet cutting.
Yeah, yeah.
It's called packet cutting. It's a word that we already use. That's what you are. If you use these, you're a packet cutter.
Yeah, that makes sense, yeah.
And actually, because here's the thing is if the public can entertain the name finger tutting.
Right. Right.
That what is tutting?
Yeah.
Where does that word come from? Mm-hmm. But I don't know what that is, but I was very quick to accept it.
Yeah.
You know, I know tutting is tutting the dance.
Right, right, right.
The word tutting, you just accept it. Mm-hmm. Packet cutting. Sure, sure. It could be called that. That looks weird enough to be called that. Let me see. This whole stream is just a promo for squids. You got me.
Well, that's.
You got me. It's just a commercial. It's one. That's all. That's the only reason why I said yes.
Can I plug squids? Yeah, I got you. I do hope to make a stream with Chase some point down the line.
If you twirl a squid, does that make you a squid flourisher? Well, I hate the word flourisher, and I hate the word squid. So it's just like the word, packet cutting. Packet cutting, and I use these things that my friend Chase called squids.
Yeah. Yeah, squids is a bit of a weird name.
It's funny because squids doesn't actually lend itself to what it is. Mm-hmm. Any more than the word card flourishing. I mean, it was funny because we were trying to – well, this is all Chase's idea. Chase came to me a while ago with this idea, and I was just like, oh, yeah, that's it. Okay. That's the answer to the problem is nobody was ever going to suggest that the problem was playing cards themselves.
Yeah.
I mean, like, no one was going to say the problem with cardistry is that we use cards. That don't make any sense. But it's true. Is that a lot of the associations come from the cards themselves. And Chase honed in on the fact that he doesn't really like a lot of the – he loves cards.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of situations where they just don't make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I love it. I love it. I love it. It's such an intuitive solution. It's just a three and a half hour commercial. You got me. You got me, Miles.
I actually think I have a button to launch an ad. I'm not going to do that, but...
You have a button to launch an ad?
I believe so. Thanks, YouTube. You
squids.
Yeah, as that happens, I get a wire transfer from Chase
You're done good, Matt. You're done good. You guys are going to push 5 hours. I don't know if I want to, like...
5 hours, I mean, you know, I'm just following the flow, but...
I don't know if I want to keep Matt up for that long.
I plan on having dinner at some point, but, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Likewise. I think we'll give it... Let's give it 15 more minutes. Let's give it 15 more minutes.
Let's time box this.
It's 9:45 right now. Let's give him 15 more minutes. That'll make it a four-hour stream.
All right, that's honorable.
Yeah, we could have done it if we wanted.
We could have done it easily.
What's the difference between Pat and Jesus? Pat is better. You know what? Speaking of the truth, I'm just kidding. I don't know. Jesus is great. What do you think is the future for cardistry? Best cars alive. And honestly, I think that we're going to get very, very well networked. We're already incredibly well networked. It's just a matter of finding the correct form factor to present it to the rest of the world. And I think that Best Cars Alive is a very fair shot at that. Yeah.
How do you feel about cardistry.io?
Or is it like cardistry.io? Or like cardistry.io? Cardistry.io or something like that. I don't know. I actually don't know any of the details about that. Is that like a forum?
No, it's basically like an enhanced version of Instagram/Reddit. And the idea is that it's more YouTube video oriented, but the idea is that you gather all of those in one place and can interact and whatnot.
We played around with that idea for Best Cardists Alive, the idea of having an app that organizes SoundCloud, Instagram, and YouTube, and that we would have podcasts on SoundCloud. Mm-hmm. YouTube videos could be housed there. And then if anybody wanted to release a download, they could do it through the app. Mm-hmm. We could still do that, honestly, just because it's just the Best Cardists Alive app. It doesn't have, like, they can still have their hub. And we could just make our little thing and people can, you know, mess around with it. But I think that having a hub is important. I think that having a place of highest significance is very important.
Right.
Like a nexus, more like. Mm-hmm. You make a nexus is a better word for what I think we're looking for. I mean, like nexus, hub, kind of being around the planet. It's kind of very similar. I think a hub is the center point. Whereas a nexus is the point of highest significance. So I kind of, you know, I think that's more so what Best Cardists Alive is aiming to be. And if he's aiming to be more of a hub, I think that that's healthy. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think it all depends on how it plays out, how it's executed.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, from what I saw, it looks pretty solid. What it needs is that it needs to be in such a format that you can just kind of kill time and scroll through it. That's all it needs.
I'm sorry, but he lost round one for our sins. That's my favorite thing I read this time. Shuffler 6900. You just, shouts. That's amazing, man. Do I want to have a New Jersey gym? New Jersey sucks balls, bro. Sucks ass. I'm just kidding. New Jersey's fine.
Y'all should come to Boston.
Boston represent. Are you in Boston? Do you live in Boston?
I do at the moment. And during the year, I'm slightly out of Boston. But basically, yeah.
Dude, like, where are you from?
It's a long story, but basically,
yeah, like, really, I cannot figure out what you are.
I was born in France. I was born in France.
Oui.
And lived there for like 15 years, and then hopped around town a bit. Last year, I was living in New York. This year, I'm living in the Boston area, and here I am today in this very chair.
And now you're just killing it, man. killing him softly. I feel you.
Killing him softly.
Are you coming to CC17 LA? I am. I'm trying my absolute hardest to be there. I can't imagine missing this one, being that it's in the goddamn country.
Yeah.
I couldn't go to Berlin, guys. It's so expensive. You maybe come to Mexico? I'll come to Mexico someday. Honestly, bro, my goal, I want to do a USA tour. I think that would be a lot of fun. And I would love to do a South America tour. And if we did a South America tour, we would hit Mexico first.
Yeah, dude. That makes sense.
Yeah, good, because you're on the way. You're on the way. You're going to go like, all right, Mexico, and then we'll go to there. But I just think that would be so fun, man.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
South America, we might all die, but like South America, let's do it.
Just don't get pregnant. You'll be fine.
Adam Sharp, when I meet you, better like bow down or something when I meet you. That'd be hysterical. Chile, come on, she can screw Canada. Brazil is cool. Yeah, honestly, I would have to get, I would want to see South American cardists would have to hit us up, hit up Best Cardists Alive, you know, tell us what locations they want us to come to. I would love to. It would be incredible. The tour with, like, the Best Cardists Alive guys.
Yeah.
And, like maybe get, like, Cardists for Touch along with this.
Yeah.
Come on. That would be a sick project. I would love that. Get road trip. Get
by
a
the
big
way,
yeah, man.
Montreal has a pretty decent cardist scene. I've been up there a few times because of
Montreal,
reasons. Yeah, no, they have
How many kids in the turnout? Like how many? Like per jam? How much?
Per jam, in my experience, it's like between 5 and 10.
Nice. Yeah. At the East Coast jam, we had close to 20 kids.
Oh, wow. Beginning. Nice.
Yeah. Yeah, man. That was great. The East Coast is like East Coast, bro.
Yeah.
Where are you at, man? J.TRA. Why don't you come to jams ever? You suck. That's why you don't come to jams. Where are you at, bro? You're East Coast. You're not East Coast. East Coast. This stream has made me realize that Patrick is indeed God. I am glad. I have converted you.
Well, my work here is done.
Yeah. Just end the stream there.
Yeah. Like, all right, yep, back it up, boys.
With you and also with you. Dude, the East Coast Gem was great, man. If you like the next chance you guys get to make an East Coast jam, you got to. I gotta say, like, I mean, the Portland jam scene's pretty tight. You know, I heard that was tight. I'm trying to get Chase to come to an East Coast jam one of these days. The East Coast infrastructure is dope.
Yeah,
it's really good.
Yeah,
it's just it's so fun. I was talking to them because I'm like, we gotta beat the West Coast guys. Yeah. But like, what's funny is that there aren't many West Coast jams.
No.
So we totally are, like, we're definitely winning, if that's a thing.
Yeah, so, we're winning a battle that there just isn't.
In the race. You're selling my username for $5? I feel so special right now.
It's cold.
No, I'm fine, bro. Forget Chuck Norris. Forget Morgan Freeman. It's Pat. Yeah, bro. Oh, Max. Dude, Max did go to Chile. I forgot about that, yo. Like, yo, Max did go down there once, and that was like before I was even talking to him. Yeah, yo, that's funny, man. That was when they used to scare me. Do you think aerials help expand cartridge? You would ask me that, Luke. You and your aerials. You and your assisted cardistry. I love you. Do you think aerials help expand cardistry? I think stunts are great. I think stunts are awesome. The idea, like, let me have, like, a really high-risk, high-payoff moment, you know, and then that's just, like, my style. You know, I think the Russians really brought that back.
Yeah, definitely.
It's awesome. Really cool. I like the fact that that was, like, really normal at one point. You know what I mean? Like, the whole foot catch and spread transfers. You remember when Chase did the foot catch for the first time?
Yeah.
Dude, that was the first time that I remember just being actually blown away by just somebody's proficiency.
Yeah.
I was just not creativity. It was just like, this is just like this
hard.
Wow, this guy is skilled, man.
Yeah, then in his fucking shot into back palm.
Yeah, bro.
Yeah.
Napalm. Oh my God, napalm. Napalm is crazy. And that's a great name too. Yeah, yep. Stunts totally expand cardistry. I think stunts are fantastic.
About stunts is that there is something kind of, well, I don't know, maybe that's just me being a pompous asshole, but there's something kind of easy about doing something that's obviously hard. And you know, like the Ernie's Goran stuff is cool because, you know, it looks cool, but you know, it could go, I don't know. How about this? Yeah. You get you get credits for doing something that is just technically difficult. So all you have to do is just kind of grind at it and then you'll get it eventually.
I have a question for you.
Is there
such thing as fake cardistry?
Fake cardistry. Ooh.
Is cardistry something that can be actually faked? Like if you use a gimmick or you fold cards, you do this and that. Is that fake cardistry? Huh.
Well, I mean, so have you ever seen Ryoma's gimmick to make like an instant?
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
That's cardistry to me.
Oh yeah.
It's all card art to me, man.
Yeah, yeah.
If you want to talk about cheating, mm-hmm. Let's talk about Anthony's. I don't think this is cheating, but Andrew Avila his spinning?
Yeah.
Prism? His spinning rhombus. The spinning rhombus doesn't. I thought that used edges that were like slightly folded or something like that, or whatever, like crimped cards or something like that.
Really?
I could have sworn he said that was the case, but whatever. Whatever it is. I've talked to many cardists that do something along those. I don't even know if fake cardistry exists.
I'm not sure.
Because if you can create the visual appeal, right? Yeah. Like if you can create the visual, is that like is there a creative like and I'm appreciating your creativity.
Yeah, that's all it comes down to, really. It's just
that's funny, right?
You make cards do cool things. Sure.
I haven't thought about that till today. Like, is fake cardistry real? Does that exist?
One thing that is almost there maybe is taping packets together.
Yeah. But at that point, and that's a little weird. I just say get some of these. You know what I mean? You can't afford these. Is it cheating? I mean, we're not cheating. Is it less cardistry?
Yeah. You know? And so Shiv and D4.
Dope Fiend.
Yep.
Love that video. Very
good video. Yeah.
Very creative stuff. Like if you can't, my whole thing with squids is like, if you can't be visually inspired by somebody using squids, it's your fault.
Yeah.
It's your fault. It's your problem. And you got to figure out what you're missing because like that's just visual inspiration with rectangles. You're not gonna connect more to anything else in the world. Hmm. You know, so just take it for what it is. Jesus. Scotch tape black. Jesus Christ, Adam. Calm down. Calm down. But I don't think that I don't think it exists, honestly. I think even if people do use assisted cardistry, I couldn't care less. You thought of it. You know what I mean? You thought of it. Like, even if I think to stick something to my fingers or bend these cards here or do that, like, I still have to think of the thing.
Yeah.
You know, I still have to think of, like, what comes after that, and that's still remarkable.
Yeah.
But
one person did point out, you know, how you'll see pictures of one-handed cuts that just can't exist.
Yeah. That's fun. Well, you know what that is, though, right? It's just if you claim a grip, you can prove that you've been working on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then if it ever comes up, you can just show them that post. Like, I've been working on it. Frustrating. It's so annoying that, like, you have to keep your videos up to prove that you did it first.
Yeah, there's...
Yeah, I can't just be like they can't be honest about it, but whatever. I mean, we're in a pretty economic community.
I feel like we're doing all right.
We're doing better. we're doing better than we were before, especially because of Instagram. Mm-hmm. 3 a.m. 3 a.m. All right. Yep. Probably time to get off.
Yeah.
Get off. 15 minutes are up. All right. All right.
All right. Well, thank you for joining me for this fun time.
Thank you for inviting me, man. I had an amazing That was really fun, bro. We could have gone for 5 hours for sure.
Oh, yeah. Easy. Yeah. Easy.
I could have gone. That could have gone to tomorrow just because I said I wanted to. God. Oh my god. All right, man. Real nice talking to you, man. And thanks to everybody for watching. Thanks for all the questions. It was really fun.
This was fun.
My name's gonna stay Patch God.
Sounds good. I'm glad this came out of that.
Of this day. And if anybody ever questions it, just send them this stream and they'll feel like they were out of the loop. But all right. I love all you guys. Thank you so much for being here.
Peace out, y'all.